Eagle 95.1, WUPN, Paradise, Sault Ste. Marie.
It's time for The Game. Eagle 95.1 proudly brings you The Game, the Twin Soos' only regional and national sports show. For the next hour, we'll get an in-depth look at sports in the Eastern Upper Peninsula and Algoma region and hear from coaches and players involved in The Game. Now, let's join Scott Nason at the Wicked Sister on Ashman Street in downtown Sault Ste. Marie, Michigan, for tonight's broadcast of The Game on Eagle 95.1.
Time to play the game. Time to play the game!
Greetings and salutations, and welcome to The Game on Eagle 95.1 and online at thegamesportshow.com, thegamesportshow.podbean.com, and on YouTube at the Scott Nason channel. My name is Scott Nason, host of The Game on this beautiful Monday night in downtown Sault Ste. Marie, Michigan. Sunny skies, temperatures close to 80 degrees, and beautiful weather expected throughout most of this week. And we are at the Wicked Sister every Monday night during summer for the most part. We'll have a couple vacation days mixed in here or there, but we'll be here every Monday night from 6 to 8 o'clock talking local, regional, and national sports. We'll be joined later on tonight by Butch Davis from the Telegram News and Butch on Sports, who will get us up to date on what's going on in the Metro Detroit sports world. Lots of news to talk about, including some breaking news today for the Detroit Pistons. And then Dave McCaig will be joining us, host of the Game Sports Show, Soo Ontario from Boston Pizza and Sportscenter Bar and Grill. He'll be joining us on the roundtable. But we have a brand new contributor to our sports show, The Game. She's no stranger to those that have listened to The Game. Normally, you won't hear her, but you'll hear about her, as she is our broadcast engineer. But she's expanding her roles with Eagle 95.1, including right here as our newest contributor on The Game, ladies and gentlemen, Katie Wollan, joining us here at the Wicked Sister. Katie, thanks for joining the show.
Wow, Scott, I'm flattered. That was a great introduction. I couldn't have asked for anything better. Well, thank you for having me.
And I didn't even practice that.
No,
that was just right off the cuff. So, Katie, we appreciate you coming down. You have a good knowledge of the world of sports, and so that's why we wanted to have you come on. And plus, we kind of needed a female voice. There's a little too much testosterone in the room sometimes with myself, Butch, especially EJ and Dave. But it's nice to have you on here, Katie. And you're going to be joining us from time to time, hopefully on a weekly basis, but whenever you can get in. And there's a lot to talk about in the world of sports. What we do first is we talk about local sports, and we have lots of local sports to talk about. And let's start with what happened in high school baseball and softball this weekend. It was regional time, as we had three teams that were still alive in high school baseball and softball. Let's start with the baseball. First, the Rudyard Bulldogs. They hosted their regional on Saturday. And boy, they were close to advancing to their second straight quarterfinal in Division 4. They had a two-run lead in the bottom of the seventh inning and two outs before giving up three runs in the bottom of the seventh inning and losing to Indian River Inland Lakes by the score of 7-6. Sophomore Nathaniel Wadry delivered the game-winning single to left center to give Inland Lakes their first regional title since 1998. Rudyard finishes the season 19-16. Noel McLeod had two hits and four RBIs for Rudyard, while James Burton was 2 of 3. Burton also pitched the distance in the regional final, allowing three earned runs on nine hits, striking out six and walking one. Indian River advances to the Division IV quarterfinal in Petoskey on Tuesday afternoon, where they will take on Gaylord St. Mary's. The Bulldogs did win their regional semifinal by the score of 8-0. And Katie, that's tough for a baseball team. You're one out away. It's kind of like having a big lead at the end and watching another team take the run and do it. It's a tough way to lose a ball game, isn't it?
Oh, yeah, of course. I would never want to be that team. But, you know, sometimes it happens, and you just have to move forward.
That's right, and Rudyard will be back next year, no doubt about it. The Soo High Blue Devil baseball team also involved in regional action on Saturday in Gaylord in Division II, and they dropped a 6-4 decision to Muskegon Oak Ridge in that Division II regional semifinal. Oak Ridge would win the regional by beating Big Rapids 8-3 for their first ever regional title. They advance to the D2 quarterfinal at Central Michigan on Tuesday, where they will take on Saginaw Swan Valley. Soo High trailed 2-0 before scoring four runs in the top of the sixth inning to take a 4-2 lead before Muskegon would come back for four runs of their own in the bottom of the inning. Drew Larson went 2-for-4 in that regional final for the Blue Devils with an RBI. Logan Bailey started on the mound, gave up four runs on nine hits and five innings, and Shane Thompson pitched the final inning, allowing two runs on two hits. So both baseball teams that were alive this weekend, seasons are over. And there was one very big upset in Division III, as the number one team in the entire state of Michigan, Traverse City St. Francis, who lost just one game in the regular season, they were upset by Gladstone, 8-4 in 10 innings, in a game that took over 4 hours to play. As the Braves will advance to the Division III quarterfinal in Petoskey on Tuesday, where they will take on Standish Sterling. One other note in high school baseball, Bay College, which is located in Escanaba, Michigan, announced last week that three Soo High Blue Devil seniors will be part of their first ever baseball team as the Norse set to begin play in 2019. Logan Bailey, Alex Morehouse, and Avery Tonight, all of Soo High, will play their baseball next season. So that's good news there, Katie, for some local players. We see quite a few that go down to Kellogg Community College, yes. Lansing Community College, but now a UP college, Bay College, they're going to have a baseball team next year. It's kind of cool, isn't it?
It is really cool. I've actually heard Bay Denock getting some sports up in there, so that's great to hear because most of them are downstate, like you said.
Yeah, we'll keep an eye on those gentlemen and, of course, the Bay College Norse. Softball, which happened over the weekend. One team was alive, and the Rudyard Bulldogs made school history, winning their first ever regional final and advancing to their first ever quarterfinal in softball. And they did so in convincing fashion on Saturday as they steamrolled through the competition in Norway. The city, not the country, Katie. That would be tough on the mileage. The Bulldogs topped Ironwood in the regional semifinal by the score of 10-0. And they advanced to meet Ishpeming as Ishpeming survived an 11-inning game against Rapid River in the other semifinals. Matter of fact, the regional final didn't get underway till almost 4 o'clock. And Rudyard got out their whooping sticks. They got out to a 5-0 lead, and they won going away by the score of 14-2 as the Bulldogs smashed 16 hits in the final, including Jordan Spring, who had 4 hits and 3 RBIs. Freshman sensation Morgan Bickle had 3 hits and an RBI, and Emily Curtis pitched both games for Rudyard on the mound. She had 2 hits and drove in 2 runs in that district final. Curtis on the mound allowed just 5 hits, striking out 4 and not allowing a walk. And against Ironwood, Curtis just allowed 1 hit, striking out 7 while walking 2. In the semifinal, Bailey Van Sloten and Morgan Bickle had 3 hits each in that game against Ironwood, while Haley Van Sloten added 2. So Rudyard, 29-7 on the season, will advance to their first ever quarterfinal, which will be taking place in Petoskey on Tuesday at 2. And they're going to take on Roger City, the number one team in all of Division IV, who knocked off the defending state champion in Division IV, Indian River Inland Lakes. And so the winner of that game Tuesday will advance to the D4 semifinals at Michigan State University on Friday, where they will take on the winner of Frankfort and Coleman. So, Katie, the Rudyard Bulldogs, a softball program that has really been built over the last 9-10 years under previous coach Pat Van Sloten and brand new coach, or I shouldn't say new coach, Kurt Kukuski has been there for a while, but this is a program that just keeps getting better and better. They've won districts. They win their first ever regional. Pretty good job there by the Bulldogs.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, I'm definitely not surprised. I know when I used to play softball probably 5-6 years ago, whenever that was, Scott, I'm not quite sure, but they've always been a dominant team, like, and that's – definitely what Rudyard's good at is softball and baseball, in my opinion.
Yeah, we're looking to get their head coach, Kurt Kukoski, on the show next week, so stay tuned. Hopefully, hey, maybe we'll talk about a state championship. Yes. Why not? They've gotten this far, right?
Exactly.
In other softball news, as far as UP teams, well, UP and Northern Michigan teams are doing very well, as there are three teams still alive across the divisions. Nagani in Division III knocked off Gladstone 2-1. They'll take on Sanford Meridian Early College in a Division III quarterfinal in Petoskey at noon, right before the Rudyard game. Division II Escanaba is crushing everybody as they won their two regional games by a combined score of 22-0. They'll take on Saginaw Swan Valley in a quarterfinal at Central Michigan on Tuesday. And the Alpena Wildcats, also alive in high school softball in Division I, they'll be involved in a quarterfinal as well on Tuesday. So, Kenny, I wanted to talk a little bit about the different programs as far as kind of the standard bearers in the Eastern Upper Peninsula as far as the individual sports. And, well, I think you have to put Rudyard right now as the standard bearer as far as high school softball. You see a good program with Soo High, a good program out in Newberry, a very improved program at St. Ignace, Pickford, Cedarville, a program that's down a little bit this year, but they've been up. But you got to put Rudyard at the top of that list, and I would say you have to put their baseball team as well, nine straight districts. You said it. Rudyard, you think baseball, softball,
yes,
don't you?
Yes, for sure. Always. I've always thought that, and they're continuing on that legacy, and that's great for them.
And you look at going to high school basketball. We're going to talk more about high school basketball in a moment, but no question, the top team as far as high school basketball for the girls, the St. Ignace Saints. I mean, all you have to do is look at the banners hanging in St. Ignace, five state championships. I mean, they do it year in and year out, Doreen and Doug Ingles. I mean, you want to talk about a program in general to emulate in any sport, then you got to say St. Ignace
yes,
girls
it's
basketball.
Definitely St. Ignace girls basketball. They're so consistent. They've had the same coaches throughout all these years, and they're going to continue to be this way, you know.
Boys basketball, really the standard bearer continues to be Cedarville. They're a team that has won a state championship over the last 10 years, a team that wins districts. They win regionals. Of course, Dave Duncan, the coach before, brand-new coach John Duncan. It's a Duncan tradition in Cedarville. They do
still
it year
family.
In and year out, still in the family. Mm-hmm. Football, you have to also give that one to St. Ignace. Head coach Marty Spencer in his tenure getting to some state finals and semifinals. Some other teams around the area. Pickford's kind of a team that is building a good program in eight-man football, but got to give it to St. Ignace as far as high school football.
Yeah, I mean, I haven't watched much high school football, but I definitely was at that Pickford game, and I'm very very surprised on how good they've been doing in eight-man, and they still have a lot of young kids going, and they're going to be successful. And just like you said, I'm sure St. Ignace is going to be very successful in the football field as well.
Hockey, very easy because there's only one school that has a hockey team, the Soo High Blue Devils, but you look at what head coach John Ferroni has done with that team before him, Doug LaPrade getting to state finals, and that new head coach Rick Mackey hopefully will be joining us on the game sometime. Soo High Hockey is always a program that's going to have something to say as far as who's going to be state champion.
Yeah, especially you have the call of the game sometimes. Tim Ellis, our boss, has the call of the game, and you guys do such a great job. And they always seem very competitive. They have a great program, and hats off to the coaching staff there.
Absolutely. Let's continue with the local sports talk here on the game on this Monday night. And there was a lot of news in the world of hockey, and one of the big stories of the past week was the Soo Greyhounds head coach Drew Bannister announcing that he is the new head coach of the American Hockey League's San Antonio Rampage of the American Hockey League. As I mentioned, this is an affiliate from the St. Louis Blues. As on behalf of the organization, we would like to congratulate Drew on his new coaching opportunity. It has been a real pleasure to work aside Drew and watch him evolve as a coach over the past 3 years. This from general manager Kyle Raftus. Originally hired on July 10th, 2015, Bannister became the 19th head coach in Greyhounds team history. Over the past three seasons, the Sudbury, Ontario native accumulated an overall record of 136-50-18 behind the Hounds bench to go along with three consecutive postseason berths, two West Division titles, and this year the 2018 Hamilton Spectator Trophy as the Ontario Hockey League regular season champions. This past season, the Greyhounds had a franchise record-setting year under Bannister, including 55 wins, 116 points, and he was subsequently named 2018 OHL and CHL Coach of the Year. Bannister Stead, I am very excited about the opportunity that begins here today, but this wouldn't have been possible without the support I received from the players over the past three seasons, the staff within the Greyhounds organization, including Joe Sorella, Ryan Ward, Kyle Raftus, the late Dr. Lukinda, Tim Lukinda, and the rest of the board of directors for their assistance and opportunity, stated Drew Bannister. And this, according to SooToday.com's Brad Cochimilio, who is a contributor to our sports show, the Game Sports Show, Soo Ontario from Boston Pizza. He says that the Greyhounds, well, a time frame has not been set, but the Greyhounds don't plan on wasting any time when it comes to finding a replacement for Drew Bannister. The search officially began last week when Bannister was hired by the St. Louis Blues to coach their American Hockey League affiliate. And in the meantime, the vacant Greyhound position is, well, obviously going to be interesting to see who they hire. General Manager Kyle Raftus said it's going to be an interesting process and not something we're going to rush. It's about finding the right fit for us. So we'll keep an eye on that as far as the Soo Greyhounds and who they may have as their brand new head coach. And the Ontario Hockey League schedule, well, part of it has been announced as the first week as far as the home openers were announced by the Ontario Hockey League today, and the Soo Greyhounds will start their season on Wednesday, September 19th, as they will be in Saginaw, and their first home game will be on Friday, September 21st, at the SR Center against the Sarnia Sting, and the brand new schedule for the 2018-2019 season will be announced tomorrow. So, Katie, Soo Greyhounds, obviously a big draw around here. They're going to have a new coach. They're going to have a new season. And, hey, hockey really never sleeps, does it?
Not here, it doesn't.
Not here, it doesn't. Good answer. The Soo Eagles announced via Twitter as they have three players they have signed from Soo Ontario, including Caleb Wood, Rafe Prasner, and Owen Shear for the 2018-19 season. They finished second, third, and fourth on the scoring chart for the Soo Greyhounds of the Great North Midget Hockey League during last season. All three players born in the year 2000 have up to 3 years of junior hockey eligibility. And so the Greyhounds already making noise as far as players they want to sign for next season. Soo Ontario football. The Soo Sabercats fall to 1-1 on the season as a late field goal was the difference, as the Sabercats fell to the Waterloo Region Predators 8-7 on Saturday at Superior Heights. Waterloo's Aiden Merchant kicked a 15-yard field goal. Remember, the goalposts are a little closer to the end zone line there, Katie. If you watch CFL, you know, the American football has the goalpost at the end of the end zone. CFL has it kind of in the middle, so if you don't say 15-yard field goals very much. I couldn't kick one of those, mind you. Hit it at the dying seconds of the game to give the Predators a narrow 8-7 win. Sabercats would take the lead early as Taylor Holp caught a 17-yard touchdown pass from a Jordan Robinson right. Greg Caruso ran for 127 yards on 25 carries for the Sabercats, as the Sabercats will return to action on June 16th at home against the Sudbury Gladiators. Kickoff will be at Superior Heights, set for 4 o'clock on June 16th. High school basketball. Katie, you and I were talking about this before we went on the air, but there are quite a few positions that are open around the area, as there will be lots of new coaches starting the 2018-2019 season. In girls basketball, there are job openings in Brimley and Pickford for both the boys and the girls, and in Rudyard for the boys. Now, there are some rumors as far as potential people who may have already been picked, but the only one we can confirm right now is former boys coach Matt Bathey. He is the brand new girls basketball coach at Brimley, taking over for Ray Bell, who announced his retirement over the last couple weeks. He was at the helm of the program for 16 years. He's going to be a guest on the game coming up here in the next few weeks to talk about his career and maybe what he has in store for his next basketball experience. But Katie, you and I have worked around Matt, a guy that did great things with the Brimley Bays boys program, taking over a program that nobody really wanted, putting them up and making the regional finals this year. He's going to get a shot at girls basketball. I like the move.
I do like the move, too. I mean, Ray Bell's been there a long time. He's a great coach, and, you know, he's ready to leave, and Matt has a great knowledge of the game, and this is going to be great news for the girls because I know they've been struggling the past couple years.
Yeah, it's really going to be interesting to see. And we should have some confirmations on some of the other head coaching jobs in Pickford, Rudyard, and the Brimley boys new head basketball coach. And once we get those confirmations, we'll share it here on your local sports leader, The Game. Lake Superior State University announced this past week the 2018 season schedule for the volleyball team. Featuring 9 matches inside the Bud Cooper Gymnasium, the year will kick off with 2 preseason tournaments for the Lakers, beginning with the Ferris State Invitational August 23rd and 25th. Then the Lakers will travel to the Northern Michigan Invite on August 31st through September 1st. The GLIAC conference season will start on Friday, September 7th, as the Lakers will host Northern Michigan University, followed by a Saturday matchup on September 8th against Michigan Tech. Following their 2-game homestand, the Lakers will hit the road for 5 straight matchups against Saginaw Valley, Wayne State, Ashland, Ferris, and Northland. And then the Lakers will return home on September 28th, taking on Purdue Northwest, while GLIAC newcomer, Wisconsin Parkside will be at the Bud Cooper Gymnasium on September 29th, Davenport on October 5th, and Grand Valley on October 6th. Lakers will also take part in the Midwest Regional Crossover Tournament held in Indianapolis, October 12th through the 13th. The Lakers will resume GLIAC action on October 19th with a road match against Michigan Tech, followed by Northern on October 20th. And the regular season will end with 3 matches against Northwood, October 26th, Ferris, October 27th, and Saginaw Valley State, November 3rd. And Katie, we talked about this a couple weeks ago. Lakers really putting a new focus as far as the volleyball program, as they want to make that their premier Division II sport. No offense to the women's basketball team, but they need to do some improvements as far as the facilities at Lake Superior State University. And the board did announce that later on in July they're going to close the pool, and they're going to do some renovations as far as Lake Superior State University's North Center. They're going to have a brand new volleyball court. They're going to have some sky boxes, better locker rooms, and so hopefully the program will improve and follow suit.
Yeah, for sure. And they also have a new coach in there. I mean, he's been there for a year, and I think this will be a great move for the volleyball team because I know they've struggled in the past. So great move by the athletic director right there.
Scott Nason and Katie Wollan broadcasting from the Wicked Sister on Ashman Street on this Monday night edition of The Game. Coming up after this break, Katie and I are going to talk a little basketball, including the Detroit Pistons and the NBA Finals. Later on, we'll talk to Butch Davis from the Telegram News and Butch on Sports, who will get us up to date on what's going on in the Metro Detroit sports scene. And then Dave McCaig will join us here at the Wicked Sister for the roundtable. One other hockey note I forgot to mention, the Soo Indians are having open tryouts June 22nd, 23rd, and 24th at LSSU's Taffy Able Arena. They'll start with practice at 7 p.m. on Friday, June 22nd. They'll have a game on Saturday, June 23rd at 10 a.m. and 4 p.m., another game on Sunday, June 24th at 9. Cost of the tryout is $125 up front, payable to the Soo Indians AAA club. And players selected as part of the Soo Indians AAA hockey club after tryouts will be required to pay a $500 non-refundable fee to hold their spot for the upcoming season. If you have questions regarding the tryouts process or anything, you can call General Manager Mike Canisto at 440-0157, Director Player of Personnel Rick Corbier at 322-2070, You can also talk to off-ice hockey operations gentleman Jerry Harwood at 630-4827. One other Laker hockey note, more of a WCHA hockey note. This just announced today that the men's league of the WCHA announced a multi-year partnership with Flow Sports. They say is the innovator in live digital sports and original content, as they are going to stream every game hosted by a WCHA member institution live and on demand exclusively at Flow Hockey TV. I wonder if that's the Flow from the Alice. Remember the show Alice, Katie? Probably not.
Your time. Not me.
Yeah, exactly. Flow was great. We need to get Mel working here. Mel was a great chef. Not as good as the chefs here at the Wicked Sister, mind you, but Mel was pretty good. That's true. We don't need Flo. We have Scott. You're right. Scott way better than Flo. Flo got nothing on Scotty. I can tell you that much right here. The agreement brings more than 180 WCHA games annually to the Flo Sports program, including all 140 league regular season games and any exhibition, preseason, and non-conference games. And so a new television partnership with the WCHA. Let's keep it going here in local sports. Katie, a couple other things I wanted to cover before we get to our next break. We talked about this a couple weeks ago with the Laker Athletic Department decision to close the school. That puts more pressure on the Soo High administration to keep open their pool. And a new group has been formed to help the future of the Soo High Pool. And one of our favorite guests, Dyke Justin, is the leader for this group. And he's also the head coach of the Soo Competitive Aquatics team. And they're going to have their first meeting, which will be held this Wednesday, 7 p.m. at the Soo Area High School Strahl Theater. This meeting is open to anyone willing to share ideas about the pool. And organizers want to gauge or get a feel of the public's level of commitment. As the administration has announced here through school board meetings that, well, they're going to have a lot of expenses if they want to continue to maintain this pool. And it's estimated that it could take about $800,000 or more to make necessary repairs and upgrades for the pool. And so they're going to have a group of three meetings, according to Dyke Justin, leader of this group. The first one will be Wednesday at 7 p.m., reaching out to the community as a whole, as well as different swimmers, user groups, and service organizations. Part two, which will be a meeting announced at some point, will have members seeking input from municipalities like the city, the county, and Sioux Tribe. And part three will include Lake Superior State University. And we're hopeful, according to Dyke Justin, that they can make a good case. And Katie, you look at, you know, not having the pool at Lake State, that's a dead issue. That's not going to happen. Soo High, with the only real viable pool besides a couple that you can swim a few people, it's really a big deal because the Soo has a great swimming program, and that goes from the youngsters ages 2 to 3 all the way up to high school. They need to figure out something, don't they?
Yeah, especially at Lake State, they had all those programs
sure.
for the
Special
older,
Olympics.
Yep, all that.
Rehabilitation,
and,
yeah.
Yeah, and that's definitely, I can't find the word to say it, but.
It's needed.
Yeah. Yeah, so. I don't know. I think Soo High should definitely keep their pool, but, I mean, I see where the money comes in play, and it's going to be a hard decision.
It's got to be something, and this is my opinion segment of the first part of the program. It's got to be something everybody needs to come on board, and everything needs to be transparent. That's one
yes.
of my biggest issues with some of the issues and some of the decisions that have been made recently, and we're not just talking sports, we're talking in general. They need to bring everybody to the table, and I think this group is a very good start and a good process to do mm-hmm. so. Instead of just complaining about things and people getting behind their keyboards and typing and making comments and ranting and raving or whatever people
yes.
do around here. I'm not on Facebook, and I'm thankful for that.
Yes.
Get everybody sit down, administration, everybody, get them to work together and come up with a solution, because I think with everybody involved, the pool will stay open, but everybody's got to come to the table. And some people are going to have to give some concessions maybe and some other things. That's what we do. We talk. We have committees. We come up with, hopefully, good solutions.
Yes, and everyone, we should always listen to Scott because he always has a great opinion when it comes to these school board
wow.
meetings. So I think you should definitely attend and share your opinion, and I'm sure our audience would appreciate that as well.
And we will get our opinion out. We'll get the information out. Hopefully we'll have Dyke Justin and maybe even somebody from the school to come on during the summer to talk about this issue. We're going to take our first break here on The Game. When we come back, Katie and I are going to discuss the Detroit Pistons and a brand new coach, which hasn't been officially announced, but pretty much it is official. We're going to get Katie's view on that, maybe what the Pistons need to do to try to right this ship and get back into the playoffs. We'll also talk about the NBA Finals.
Scott.
Come on.
I mean, I agree.
Was
but
brutal.
We all had to watch it, though.
Well, not all of us did. We're going to talk about that more coming up on The Game here on Eagle 95.1.
Get wicked at the Wicked Sister. You'll find the best tasting food for the whole family. Start off with some appetizers like the crab dip, served with warm non-bread strips and soft pretzel bites, or their antibiotic and hormone-free boneless chicken wings with 5 choices of sauces. Entrees include the barbecue pulled pork sandwich, the number one selling drunken cow burger, or Philly cheesesteaks, and they're on special all day Thursdays. The Wicked Sister also offers a gluten-free menu and catering. Bring the whole family. The Wicked Sister, downtown Ashman Street, open 7 days a week.
The Game Sports Show would like to thank an additional home to The Game Sports Show, Canadian franchise Boston Pizza. Boston Pizza, Sault Ste. Marie, located on 601 Great Northern Road, Sault Ste. Marie. Come in and join Boston Pizza for its numerous specials that are offered. After 9 p.m. daily, come in to Boston Pizza for $9 schooners, $4 rail drinks, and delicious food. Boston Pizza, Sault Ste. Marie, you're among friends.
Welcome back to the game on Eagle 95.1 and online at thegamesportshow.com, thegamesportshow.podbean.com, and on YouTube at the Scott Nason channel. Scott Nason along with Katie Wollan on this Monday night, June 11th. We'll be joined, hopefully, we're having some technical difficulties, so hopefully we can sort all those out here in the next few minutes, as we are hoping to be joined by Butch Davis from the Telegram News and Butch on Sports. We can't get our issues fixed. We will have Butch on tomorrow night on a special edition of the game. We're joined once again by Katie Wollan. And Katie, I know you are chomping at the bit to talk about the NBA, but first let's cover the breaking news which happened this afternoon, as multiple sources are reporting that the Detroit Pistons have found their next head coach. And very rarely do you get a head coach that was named Coach of the Year. Well, the Pistons did, as they hired, or they're agreeing to a deal with former Toronto Raptors coach Dwayne Casey. It sounds like it's a five-year deal worth about $7 million, according to several sources. The Pistons stayed pretty aggressive in their pursuit of Casey and closed the deal early this morning, as owner Tom Gorris and senior advisor Ed Stefanski sold Casey with an aggressive contractual commitment and a case that together they could make the Pistons a perennial playoff team in the Eastern Conference. The Pistons parted ways with head coach Stan Van Gundy shortly after this season. Van Gundy went 152-176 over his four seasons with Detroit, making the playoffs just once. And Detroit was 39-43 this season. And, well, Van Gundy wanted to return, but the Pistons said no. Casey was fired by the Raptors after the playoffs this season, being swept by Cleveland in the Eastern Conference semifinals. This after Casey recorded a franchise record 59 wins and gave Toronto the East top seed. So, Katie,
yes.
I want your opinion on the Pistons' new hire. What do you think?
On the Pistons' new hire, well, I'm actually very excited. Well, let me ask, are you excited, Scott?
I'm asking you first. I want to hear your opinion.
Okay, my opinion. I guess I'm excited not just because of he was the Toronto Raptors coach and the number one seed thing and whatnot, but I think he does a great job with younger players. Like Norman Powell, for instance, what was he, second round? No, he wasn't even drafted.
He was undrafted. Undrafted,
and he's done such a great job for the Toronto Raptors. So I think Dwayne Casey is really great with developing younger players, so that our younger players being Luke Kennard and Henry Ellenson and also Stanley Johnson. So that's my opinion, especially for the younger players and the development.
Yeah, I think it's a smart move by the Pistons. I mean, this is a guy that has won, and he
yes.
has a very different coaching style than Stan Van Gundy.
Yes.
I don't think Van Gundy's coaching style worked, and I think the results say as much. And the fact that he was general manager and coach, and Butch and I have talked about it probably for years now on this show, you need kind of a separation there. Casey, he's going to be the coach. He doesn't sound like he's going to be the GM or anything.
Correct.
But he's good at developing young talent, and the Pistons need somebody that is good at developing young talent, because you look at some of the young talent that they've picked, and you look at the drafts, and Van Gundy was responsible for, in large part, for these drafts.
Mm-hmm.
Look, going back to 2015, the Pistons select Stanley Johnson over Devin Booker. And boy, last year, Luke Kennard, and maybe those two will end up being great players, but you look at what Donovan Mitchell did this season, and the Pistons could have had him. They picked Kennard, who shot just over 40% from three-point range, and while Mitchell was Rookie of the Year. So I think you need that, and you look at some of the people, and we really don't know everybody that the Pistons interviewed, but they did interview John Beilein, who decided to stay at the University of Michigan, and San Antonio's assistant coach, M.A. Udoka, also was one of the people that were part of it. But, you know, the Pistons are in a tough spot right now, because with the Blake Griffin trade, they don't have much cap room.
No,
so they're not going to be able to go out and shop or get anybody. And they don't have a draft pick this year in the first round. So, you know, Casey's taken over a team that right now is kind of a neutral. I mean,
They
don't have a lot of options. And so they're going to need somebody to pretty much work with the pieces that they have right now.
And I definitely think it's going to be a difficult task, but I think Dwayne Casey, obviously he has the knowledge. He's a great fit for the Pistons and a lot of aspects, and I think he's going to do a great job, and I'm sure the players are going to be thrilled, and you know, they're going to work around all those things that you just said, you know, with the cap space, and you know, they gave away their draft picks for what, first round and second round. So for the next 2 years, I believe.
Yeah.
So it's going to be a little difficult. But
and the contract's just ridiculous for Griffin. And,
yes,
and that's the thing.
They
really gave up the farm to get him. And when he's healthy, he's good. He's one of the best players in the NBA. But there's that when he's healthy.
Exactly, and that contract is a bit ridiculous in my opinion, but, you know, it happens, and that was Stan Van Gundy's choice, and we'll just see what the Pistons have in store. I'm confident in them. I'm confident in Casey, and I do believe all these players have a great mindset, and they still have a fairly young class, and they have a couple older ones in there, but I think they're going to figure something out here.
Yeah, I do as well, and I think it's a good move for the Pistons. And so Dwayne Casey should be announced, I believe, either later this week or early next week, that he is officially the next head coach for the Detroit Pistons. Well, Katie, the NBA Finals were completed. And a sweep was completed by the Golden State Warriors in Game 4 after Steph Curry scored 37 points and playoff MVP Kevin Durant. I have him on my list as Duranks, but he ranks pretty high. He added a triple-double as the Golden State Warriors win their second title in a row and third in the last 4 years, winning Game 4 Friday night over Cleveland, 108-85, sweeping LeBron James and the Cavs out of the playoffs. This is the first sweep in the NBA Finals since 2007 when James and his Cavs were swept by San Antonio. Kevin Durant named the playoff MVP for the second straight year. And so two questions as far as going into next season. Where LeBron James lands?
Oh, yes.
And can anybody stop Golden State from winning their third straight championship? Before we get to those questions, Katie, just your thoughts on the NBA Finals. What did you think? What did you see?
Well, just like you kind of gave everyone that snooze in the last segment, yes, it wasn't the best finals we could ask for. It wasn't 20 points, 30 points here and there.
Game one was fun.
Yes, game one was great, and I think for the Cavaliers, if they would have had that game, I think the series would have definitely been more interesting for everyone. Yes. Any other thoughts?
Well, lots of thoughts there. I mean, you look at that game one, LeBron James scores 51 points.
Yes.
And the officials in that game, I said it during the Houston series, and did the officials cost Cleveland the series? Absolutely not. Did the officials cost Cleveland game one? I think they did. I think they got that call wrong. I think, obviously, the J.R. Smith gaffe was something that was pretty tough. Cleveland had to win that game. Do they win the series if they win that game? Probably not. But I think the series extends to at least six games.
I would have totally agreed
if they
with
win that.
Yes.
And but, you know, you look at this Golden State team, and I'm not a fan of them.
Yes, I know.
I'm not a Steph Curry fan at all.
I'm a fan of them, everyone, though.
I do know that. But you got to give it up for Kevin Durant. This is a guy that has been, I think, in 12 or 13 NBA Finals games. He scored 25 points each and every game. He doesn't have a game off.
He's very consistent.
He's consistent. You look at that game three. That was the one I thought if Cleveland was going to win a game, it was going to be that game three. And, you know, Thompson struggled.
Steph Curry struggled.
Yep. Draymond Green wasn't good. I think was Iguodala even playing in that game? I think he was still out maybe.
Yeah,
or maybe
limited minutes maybe.
Right. And he just, I mean, he was deadly. He hits that three-pointer at the end, almost the same spot he hit it last year in game three. And you got to give it up to Kevin Durant. I know Dave McCaig, not a fan of Kevin Durant.
Oh, wow.
And while I'm not a fan, do I respect his game?
Yes,
absolutely. That guy, he's cold as ice out there. I mean, is he the best player in the NBA right now outside of LeBron, which I think everyone could argue is the best player?
I totally agree with that. LeBron James is definitely the best, but Kevin Durant right behind him. I think Kevin Durant is better than James Harden because everyone's arguing that he's the MVP, right? So, yeah, Kevin Durant, definitely have to look out for him. But I just heard recent news that he thinks he might be retiring in the next 5 years.
Durant?
Yes.
Really?
Yeah, he came out with that today. So.
Wow.
Because he just kind of wants to end on a good note. And
why not?
Yeah, I mean.
So the next question, Katie, is LeBron. It doesn't sound like he's going to be back in Cleveland. I don't think there's nothing he can do in Cleveland now. He's done. There's nothing more he can do. He's got the city the title. He carried a team and literally carried a team to the NBA Finals, and you got to give him a lot of credit.
Yeah.
He did say after Game 4 that he was playing with a hand injury, and he does embellish out there quite a bit. I'll be the first to win. I'm a LeBron James fan, mind you, but he does embellish a little bit and whine, and so does Steph Curry, I might add, but they don't complain about him as much, it seems like. But LeBron James, if you had to say right now where he goes, give me a couple teams where you think he might go.
Well, I don't know if I'm biased because I kind of want him to go places, but also I think these places have the best chances. Like Philadelphia, you have Joel Embiid, you have Ben Simmons, you have Markel Fultz, you got a young crowd right there willing to work their butts off, and I think LeBron James wants to be in that kind of atmosphere, and he definitely respects them all as players. So I think that's definitely in the top three for him. And okay. then everyone argues the Lakers as well because they also have a young audience. And
sure.
he kind of, I think he would work well with younger players and helping develop them. And
it's L.A. Doesn't he have a home out there? He probably
of
has
course,
a home in
yes.
every city, doesn't
yes,
he at this point? Yeah.
Yep, he does. He does. And I know Greg Popovich reported that he's going to try his hardest to get LeBron, but I don't know. We'll see. I know that LeBron respects Pop more than any other coach in the NBA. So it's possible for the Spurs.
I think those are the three teams I'm looking at as well, Katie. I would put Philadelphia at the top of the list.
I
think LeBron wants to go to a team that is building. And while the
exactly.
Lakers are building, it's going to take them a few more years, if at all, than Philadelphia. San Antonio, as much as he likes Pop, I don't know how much Pop has left, you know, with his passing of his wife. Probably, you know, something personally that might be taking a toll on him. And a team that's still good, but they're kind of on the downswing. They have to be after dominating the NBA for 20 years. So I would say Philadelphia. There's always New York. You never know what's going to happen there. Could he stay in Cleveland? Is there any chance that he stays in Cleveland, in your opinion?
I don't know. I think the only reason why he'd stay in Cleveland is because, I mean, these are stupid reasons. But one, he's like, what, from there?
Sure.
He's at that age where it's like settling down and has kids. And also Kevin Love, he's been his partner in crime for the last so many years. But Kyrie has left, so, you know, I don't know. I can definitely see him leaving, but also I can see him staying.
Throw a wild card out there. Boston.
Boston, no.
Would that be interesting?
No
chance?
There's no chance because I feel he knows.
Too many stars there?
Yeah, not even just that. Like, he knows that Kyrie not has beef with him by any means. They're on okay terms, but there's no point in following him because Kyrie's trying to do his own thing, and LeBron should respect that, and I think he does.
Here's a wild card. Utah.
Okay.
Up-and-coming team. Any chance LeBron James lives in Salt Lake City? No.
Not the city, but I think he definitely respects Donovan Mitchell as a player and their team. They're doing well as well. I mean, we didn't even predict that they were going to even get into the playoffs.
Yeah. Well, that is our NBA wrap. We hope to talk more with Butch Davis here. We're working through some technical issues with the internet. We're going to try to fix those on our break. And so we'll either be back with Butch for our next break or we'll be back with Dave McCaig during our roundtable here on The Game on Eagle 95.1.
Get Wicked Catering from the crew at The Wicked Sister.
We like to think of ourselves as foodies. While our favorite foods are paired with a beer tasting at The Wicked Sister, you can now have the same creative menu for your next catered business luncheon, family get-together, wedding, or holiday party. Our white truffle risotto appeals to your gluten-free and vegetarian guests. Add sautéed shrimp or freshly grilled chicken for a pop of protein. Or let us build you a custom menu to suit your needs. From plated events of 15 to buffets for 200, The Wicked Sister will cater your event with tapas, snacks, craveables, or a full sit-down dinner.
The Wicked Sister, where you'll be treated like family, whether you like it or not.
The Game Sports Show would like to thank an additional sponsor and additional home to The Game Sports Show, Sportscenter Bar and Grill. Sportscenter Bar and Grill, located on 624 Wellington Street West, Sault Ste. Marie, Ontario. Sportscenter rated top sports bar for the second year in a row. At Sportscenter, enjoy their famous 75-cent wing night along with delicious Molson products on tap, along with a great atmosphere and other great food options available as well. Sportscenter Bar and Grill, the Sioux's best sports bar.
Check out our brand new website up and running now at thegamesportshow.com. There you can find past broadcasts of all our shows from the Wicked Sister in Sault Ste. Marie, Michigan, and Boston Pizza and Sportscenter Bar and Grill in Sault Ste. Marie, Ontario. As well, you can find our brand new t-shirts available for just $25 a shirt. All sizes are available and proceeds will go towards Northern Critters in Need and Big Brother, Big Sister of Sault Ste. Marie, Ontario. Now you can purchase the shirt by emailing thegamesportshowssm@gmail.com. Please state the total amount of shirts and size needed. They have payment options available, e-transfer, or cash upon delivery, as a shirt can be delivered to your location if you live in the Sault Ste. Marie, Michigan, and Ontario area free of charge. TheGameSportsShow.com, where you find all your local, regional, and national sports that you just can't get enough of. Welcome back to the game on Eagle 95.1 and online at thegamesportshow.com, thegamesportshow.podbean.com, and at the YouTube channel, easy for me to say, at Scott Nason. We are here at the Wicked Sister on Ashman Street on this Monday night, and the Wicked Sister is having another tap takeover on June 28th from the Lansing Brewery Company. They're going to be here all day to have a tap takeover. That's a good time, too, because it's right during Engineers Weekend. We'll be joined once again in the round table by Katie Wollan and our co-host, Dave McCaig, and joining us, one of our other co-hosts of the game. His name is Butch Davis. You can find him at podomatic.com, at simplybutch2, that's too.podomatic.com. You can also find him on this podcast page for his show, Butch on Sports. Butch, how you doing on this Monday night, sir?
I'm doing okay. How yourself, Scott?
Doing good, Butch, and boy, great timing to have you on because you always have the news, fresh news, information, content, and, well, we have a breaking news story this afternoon as far as the Detroit Pistons. Katie and I touched on it a little bit during our segment, but you have the official news, so why don't you tell us who the new Detroit Pistons head coach is?
Okay, the new Detroit Pistons head coach is Dwayne Casey. He joins the organization as a head coach. Casey, he'll be formally introduced at a news conference. It'll be next week after Father's Day. They say Father's Day will be the date, but I don't think so. It'll probably be on Monday, the 18th, I think, here. That is one of the things there. He's a well-respected coach. He has an outstanding record from what I pulled on up here. He had, of course, 59 wins this year. Forward to the Toronto Raptors there. He was voted Coach of the Year, then kicked out in the street after that particular ordeal here. He's been, taking it well with his wife and family and all, too. He said, I'm excited with the honor to join the Pistons franchise. The franchise of championship history with a roster is ready to win now. Casey also said that Tom won me over with his vision for the team and the city. He clearly wants to deliver for the fans in Detroit. I believe in the strength of his leadership to do so. That he's confident that this team has pieces already in place to complete a very high level. That what Casey added as well. He also said there's a lot of talent, a solid core, some exciting young players, eager to get better. We'll be getting to work right away with things to make us successful there. Again, Casey's 61 years old. He's been in the NBA 23 of the last 24 years. He went through his deal there. Also, he has the World Championship ring with the Dallas Raptors there, indeed. So he has some pedigree as far as winning a championship. He's ready to go. Can't play well with the slop jar of players that we have here in Detroit. If he can't get them to work and have some influence over the players, then he too will be out the door. The contract is for 5 years. In my estimation, it probably was the only pick that made any sense at this present time there. They had a spill of names that you know that in the past weeks I have given you names or whatnot there. I think the big thing was when John Beilein stepped down, and that to me was the obvious reason why the Pistons, they were going to interview him for the third time there. So they had to be intrigued with what he had to offer, the type of offense he ran at University of Michigan.
Butch, we're having some technical difficulties here. We're going to take a quick break here on the game. We'll try to get Butch back established here. We'll be back here on Eagle 95.1. Welcome back to the game on Eagle 95.1 and online at thegamesportshow.com, thegamesportshow.podbean.com, or go to the YouTube channel, Scott Nason. Scott Nason back here at the Wicked Sister on this Monday night, and we do have to apologize. We will not be able to have Butch Davis on for the rest of the show. We started to talk to Butch about the Detroit Pistons' newest hire, but unfortunately we had some technical difficulties, so we're going to do a special edition of the game tomorrow night with yours truly and Butch, because Butch had a lot of material for tonight's show, and so we're giving Butch the night off tonight. He can kick back and watch Monday Night Raw and such. We'll be joined by Katie Wollan once again during our round table, but without further ado, he comes all the way from Sault Ste. Marie, Ontario, and this Canadian and this American do get along despite our presidents and prime ministers. He's the co-host of this show and also host of the Game Sports Show from Boston Pizza and Sportscenter Bar and Grill. Ladies and gentlemen, ladies love him. Girls adore him, even the ones that never saw him like the way that I rhyme in a show. The reason why, man, I don't know, so let's go, cuz.
Wow.
It takes two. Dave McCaig joining us. How about that?
God, did you just watch Straight Outta Compton or something? That's a lot of rhymes.
Something like that.
Right there.
That was.
That was great.
A little karaoke on Thursday night, I might add.
Oh, that's great. I like that. I like the mojo at the beginning. You had a lot of deepness to your voice there. I like that. The mojo.
A little deepness there.
I like that. I felt a little more deepness to your voice there.
I don't get that much.
Just my ears. But Scotty, I'm doing good, pal. How you doing?
Doing well, Dave. Thanks for joining us here at the Wicked Sister.
Of course.
We were talking with Butch and also talked about with Katie there. The breaking news today is the Toronto Raptors former coach, Dwayne Casey, NBA Coach of the Year, now coaching the Detroit Pistons. What are your thoughts?
Good for him. Honestly, I don't mean that in a like good for you kind of sarcastic way. I mean that in a very good way that I'm happy for a lot of reasons. He gets back into the NBA as a coach. The Pistons are trending upwards, I feel like they're an organization that, you know, brought in Blake Griffin. They want to try to get in and get higher seed and go on in the playoffs further. And Dwayne Casey's had success with the Raptors. Let's face it. I don't care that he's lost to Cleveland. Let's put that aside. He's made it to the playoffs. The Raptors have been a very successful team for a handful of years, and Dwayne Casey's a big part of that. He's a very energetic coach. He's lively on the sidelines, which would be quite entertaining for people at Little Caesars Arena, may I add. But Dwayne Casey's going to do well in Detroit, I feel. And he has a team that he can make his own again and help bring back up in the basketball world in terms of standings. And in a conference that I know a lot of people think it's weak, but I feel like there's a lot of teams that are going to come through that conference. Like the Philadelphia 76ers are going to be a dynasty one day. I'm going to flat out say that right now, especially if they sign LeBron James this year.
Kate and I were just talking about that.
Literally just saying that you know, even he's rumored to go to the Raptors, for God's sakes, but every Raptors fan's got to really withdraw and pump the brakes on that. I feel LBJ is going to be a Laker or 76er. But you know what? The Pistons are an attractive market for somewhere to go as well. I'm not going to say LBJ is going to go over to the Pistons, but with Blake Griffin being there and having Drummond there and having those guys present with the Pistons, they have a good team that can be a good playoff team that could get past the first round and so on and so forth. And Dwayne Casey, great hiring. I'm very happy that he did get hired because I'm very upset that the Raptors did fire him. And I told you that. I understand that somebody had to go, somebody had to eat it, and it was Casey that did, because they're blaming him about losing to Cleveland because of a lot of reasons. I just want to shake up the team. I think you got to look at themselves in the mirror, like DeMar DeRozan and Kyle Lowry and Jonas Valanciunas, or as Barkley would say, Valanciunas.
Wow.
Either way, like however you want to say his name, he played like a Valanciunas in that series. So I feel that the Raptors could have went a different direction, and whatever's the Raptors' loss is the Pistons' gain in this, in my opinion.
We talked about this with Katie. I wanted to get your thoughts here, Dave, so we don't have to recover it on the roundtable. NBA Finals, Golden State sweeps Cleveland. Pretty disappointing finals as far as excitement, except in that game one. 3 out of 4 years, Golden State wins. They'll probably win again next year. Your thoughts on the NBA Finals?
Yawn.
Yeah, that's what I said.
Like,
I literally
quick sheet. If you want to go for a nap, you know, I listen to white noise. If I can't sleep, put on some white noise, right? Some people do that. But you know what? If you want to get a nice siesta in or go to sleep, you put on the NBA Finals.
Put on Nickelback. They put me right to sleep.
Ouch.
They suck.
People either hate or like Nickelback. And I know we don't use that word, but those are the two words.
I'm bordering on that.
Yeah, I know. And that's surprising because you might not
and
like
it. It's not because they're Canadian. I like Loverboy. They're Canadian. I like Celine Dion.
And I do
Shania.
Like Nickelback. I'm not going to lie. I do.
Brian Adams.
But Brian Adams, Summer 69.
Justin Trudeau. Maybe not.
Donald Trump, though.
Yeah.
That's
it's kind of a wash.
Yeah, but the thing is with... You know, the finals this year, the winner that was supposed to win won. Yeah. And I thought the series would be a bit more entertaining. You know, let's just say game one, let's say J.R. Smith would have not been a doorknob and actually put the layup up and wasn't doing whatever he did before the game.
Yeah.
That's all I'm going to say. Yeah, I feel that the Cleveland still would have lost in five then. Let's say they would have won
six.
Game one.
They might have won one at home, yeah.
Maybe. I just think Golden State, no. The winner that was supposed to win won, like I said. And I don't think they're going to win next year, Scotty. I really don't. I really think there's going to be someone from the East is going to win. I'm not going to say the Raptors.
Philadelphia with LeBron. Easy for
maybe,
me to say.
Maybe. I'm not going to say that enough spread rumors, but let's spread rumors. Philly is – I look at them and I look at the Minnesota Timberwolves and I see two teams that are a lot alike that are going to be in the finals against each other very soon because of their youth and the stars in their lineups. Look at Towns and Wiggins from Minnesota and Jimmy Butler. They have good guys in Minnesota, you know, and they're growing. And look at the Philadelphia 76ers, hashtag trust the process, right? Did I say that? I think it was.
You got it.
Trust
yep.
the process. Mm-hmm. So they have Simmons there. You got Joel Embiid there, and Coangelo stepped down, rightfully so, because he had to. He had to step down. Coangelo had to be removed from his job or step down because he was, let's just say, making fake accounts on Twitter.
You don't want to do that.
But, you know, that might have almost pushed away LeBron James from almost going to the 76ers. I bet you that's a big reason why they said, hey, look, step down and we won't fire you. It won't cause anything. So I think the Eastern Conference or the Raptors still have a chance next year. They have the same team coming back on that court, and they're going to have a new coach, sure, that might change a little dynamic. Maybe they'll make a move in the offseason to bring in another guy. Who knows? Maybe they will sign LeBron. Maybe they'll all be – but if they do sign LeBron, I might go streaking in the streets. Okay, that's I might say that.
Some people might want to see that.
Maybe. Some people.
Not this person. Not no this, offense.
You don't want to see it?
That's not really, no. I was in the Navy. I saw enough.
That's unfortunate. But, no, it's going to be – I think I don't think Golden State's going to get it next year. I think it stops at three, but I'm not saying they're done winning in general. But I think it's going to come from the other conference next year.
Let's move on to hockey. Dave, a couple things I wanted to touch on locally. The Soo Greyhounds, you talked about it with Brad Cacciamillo and Justin Heichel on your show from Boston Pizza last night, which you can find on thegamesportshow.com or thegamesportshow.podbean.com. Soo Greyhounds head coach Drew Bannister going to Texas to coach in the American Hockey League. Brad was talking about how the search is ongoing, but the Greyhounds aren't going to rush into just picking anybody. And really, Dave, this wasn't much of a surprise. I mean, people thought that Drew Bannister very well could be gone after this season. Well, he launched himself a pretty good gig in a good organization with the St. Louis Blues.
Absolutely. Look at the success that's been developed from the Soo Greyhounds organization with Sheldon Keefe.
Yeah.
Right? He's
picked up where the other guy left
one
off.
One went away
yeah.
from a Calder Cup so yeah. it, with the Marlies. So Sheldon Keefe and Bannister are two different coaches, though. Mm. Very different. Sheldon, you can just tell by the way they're persona is and how they are on the bench. They are two different coaches, which is why when Bannister got hired, they're going to wonder how the team was going to adjust to a different coaching style. But Bannister going over to San Antonio, there's been a lot of fans, and Brad didn't say this yesterday. This was me that was saying this. This is me reading this, that a lot of fans of Soo today were surprised that Bannister left the Soo Greyhounds.
I wasn't.
And I'm definitely not.
He has nowhere to go but down, really.
Let's get real. I said
outside,
that too.
Outside of winning it, which realistically they probably won't with the players coming back, offense.
Nope.
He has nowhere to go but down.
No, right. And he's only lost, what, less than 30 games in 3 years
right.
in the OHL. So let's say he comes next year. Let's say he stayed with the Hounds next year. He might have a season that's only 15 games above 500. He finishes sixth or fifth seed in the conference. He has an early first-round exit. You're just staying there for no reason. This year he won, broke records in wins. They went very far. They arguably should have won the OHL Cup, but they were a little gassed, if you want to use an excuse. And he won Coach of the Year. He can't go anywhere up. He's been there for a couple of years. They've had success. He had to move on. And people are criticizing him about going to a team that didn't have a regulated farm team last year. Because of St. Louis didn't have a full-fledged, full-time farm team last year. They were splitting, being loaned to teams, and doing things. So they're wondering what the security of his job is. He just signed a 5-year deal with San Antonio. He is in that organization. He is staying there. He's going to grow with St. Louis. The plan is obviously to have him move up, or even for him to grow and even to be an assistant coach in the organization. He has opportunity to grow within St. Louis. And I really think that Bannister made the wise decision for going to the AHL because you have to move up. You have to better yourself. I know
right.
people like to look out for other people
sure.
in general, but you have to look out for yourself. Yourself is top priority number one, and Bannister did that. And you know what? There was even rumors of him going to Belleville, which is right outside where he lives, Ottawa's farm team. But he made the right decision based on the fit for him, and I feel the players coming up in St. Louis, he has a lot of young guys in that organization he gets to work with and make the team his own.
Well, you look at all the Hounds coaches here, you know, I mean, the list goes on and on. Craig Hartsburg, who you had on your show a couple weeks ago, Dave, Ted Nolan, Terry Crisp. I mean, the list goes on and on, and coaches that did well but moved to the next level and the NHL. One other thing I wanted to note before we talk about the Stanley Cup, there is still one series going on in hockey. Had a chance to watch a couple games there in the AHL, speaking of Drew Bannister, the Toronto Marlies and the Texas squad, the Texas Stars. I believe Toronto's up 3-2 in that series.
Yep, one game
well, I'll tell you what, the future is bright for the Toronto Maple Leafs watching some of those players. That's a fun team to watch.
They're amazing. I know Dermott was able to go down and play after playing in Toronto for the entire of the season with the Leafs, and he was probably their best defenseman in the playoffs against Boston, as the Boston Bruins took the Gardner Expressway to the second round, as they'd like to say. But enough hatred with Gardner. Not a fan at all. Professionally speaking, not a fan. Just for a fit. Maybe he'd be good somewhere else. Right.
Yeah, personally
speaking,
we don't care. We're talking
about. Yeah, but Travis Dermott, some guys are able to go down as a big boost to that blue line with the Marlies, and obviously some forwards being able to go down. And I really think the Marlies, having these young guys, they have a couple veterans that are down there that people don't know of, and they're just helping these young guys grow. Keith is just building that resume. Yeah. You know, the Rangers are apparently really interested in Sheldon Keith. It'd be a big loss if Toronto lost Keith, I feel. But once again, it's a plan to grow, and the Marlies have all these young guys. They have young guys on their team with the Maple Leafs in general. The future is certainly very bright in Toronto, and it won't be long until we get to see a Stanley Cup in Toronto, I think, based on these young guys coming up, as long as they do it right. And them getting the taste of these long playoff runs that they've had last year and even the year prior are a great experience for these young guys, and hopefully they can get the win and get the W to win the series, and they can have a taste of having a championship so they know how it is. Some of them move up. And that means when they go to the NHL together, they've all played together before. So the chemistry is going to be there. The leadership is going to be there. They're all going to be comfortable with each other. So it's just going to be a big asset for the Leafs in general going forward.
Well, it took the Washington Capitals 43 years to win their first Stanley Cup, so there's hope for the Leafs. I believe they're on 41 years since they've won the Stanley Cup. The Capitals finished off the Vegas Golden Knights this week, Dave, in five games, winning Game 5 by the score of 4-3. In Vegas on Thursday night, Alex Ovechkin, who probably is still under the influence of some alcohol at this point, winning his first ever cup, silencing a lot of the naysayers and saying that he couldn't win the big one. Ovechkin was named the playoff MVP. And, you know, to me, Dave, I know you talked a lot about it on your show last night, but I wanted to get your thoughts tonight. My opinion on the Stanley Cup is, after that save made by Holtby in Game 2, the save, I figured, you know what, that's it. Series over. Washington's going to win. I said it on the drive with ESPN Blacksburg with Paul Van Wagner. I said Washington was going to win the series in five after that, and they did. And it was strange for me because wearing this hat right now, I was aboard the Winnipeg Jets bandwagon.
As was I.
Wanted them to win. They get knocked out. Well, then how can you not like this Vegas story? And it was still a great story. It is a great story, and it will continue to be a great story. And I'm not a Capitals guy by any stretch. I was kind of on the fence with Washington. I didn't like them. I didn't dislike them. But as that series went along, and as I saw Ovechkin really develop into the player that a lot of people thought he could be in the playoffs, I found myself strangely kind of pulling for the Capitals, just in an odd way, because they had a lot of players that I thought were, you know, Carlson and Oshie, and just to name a few. I found myself kind of pulling for Washington and actually happy that they won the Stanley Cup. Your thoughts?
Absolutely. No, I must say first, it's 51 years for Toronto.
That was a 50. Yeah, the math's a little hazy there.
No, it's good. And the reason why I say that is because I'm getting it just eats me alive each year that they don't lift the cup.
That was unintentional, but kind of funny.
No, it had to. Yeah, you know, it felt good that you said 41. It almost made me feel like I had 10 more years to buy.
I was going back to 2008.
Yeah, no, that's good. That's good. You're allowed to do that. You know, it's a Monday. But at the end of the day with the Washington Capitals now, Colin Miller being a friend of mine and someone who's been on the show often and follows the show and plans for him this summer, we even talked about having the cup on the we've talked about a lot of things, right? And, you know, obviously I was pulling for him because of him, not just because of that for the show, obviously. But, you know, it would have been great and a great story to see the Vegas Golden Knights win. Would it have been good for the NHL? Yes. Would it have been good for Seattle? No, because the expectations would have been high. But Vegas, I wasn't really on either side pulling. I was excited for both teams. You got the Cinderella story, and you got the legacy on someone else's hand on the other side. And you got a team who hasn't won in 40-plus years. Trust me, I know how that is to have a team that hasn't won in years. You know, Vegas has had a great run. And, you know, the the tipping point for me was, yes, that save, but not even. It was the last game when Washington's already clinched to win, and Ovechkin going to get that cup in tears.
Oh.
You know, that is real. I always looked at Ovechkin as someone who's very conceited.
Sure.
You know, all that. But you know what? That's the persona that Jaromir Jagr had as well when he played. When he gave the kiss to the sky, when he was just always animated. But that's because he truly loves the game of hockey. There's somebody that will live, breathe, and die. He even kicked out his wife to sleep on the couch so he can sleep with the cup in bed.
Oh, wow.
Okay, I don't know if you read that story.
No,
okay,
I missed
that
one
story.
Out.
So there's somebody who loves the Stanley Cup, wanted to win that more than anybody, and to have somebody with that animation, that excitement, that emotion, that's something that's going to be instilled in my mind forever. It's like, you know, when you got Vladimir Konstantinov, when he won the cup with Eisner, giving him the cup after that
against
accident,
Washington,
there's a moment,
yeah.
Right, against Washington, ironically
20 years
enough.
Ago.
Exactly. Joel Sakic passing the cup to Ray Bourque.
Ray Bourque, yeah.
You know, so there's little moments in hockey that stick out to you, and that's one that's going to stick out to me is because of his pure animation excitement that he got it. Sure, I can imagine the anger and the sadness in Vegas' locker room, but they have nothing to hang their head
on. Nobody thought they'd even be there.
They never thought they'd be a 15th, 16th seed in the Western Conference this year, having a lottery pick this year. The team almost won the Western Conference and literally walked through the LA Kings and San Jose, and they walked through these guys at a tougher match against Winnipeg. But when they had to play Washington, they played a team that was, you know, maybe a little bit more rested in Washington. I feel Vegas had a tough go when it came to Winnipeg, a tough, grueling series. But Washington was able to match Vegas' intensity. That's what they were able to do. And Carlson and Devontae Smith-Pelly, those were the two guys that were the tipping point of Washington.
Yep.
Ovechkin sure was obviously Conn Smythe.
We expected that.
And I honestly, speaking of the Conn Smythe, I had Fleury winning that still.
Yeah.
I don't know why he didn't. It would have been nice first year with the team and the home ice. I pictured that for him to win, but
gave
whatever.
Gave him a lot of goals in that final,
yes, though. He did. Ovechkin deservingly won that, but I feel like 51-49 is my vote.
Yep.
But with that in general, Vegas has nothing to really hang their head about. They did fantastic. Colin Miller, I texted him a few times after he lost. I could tell very slow answers, okay? He's hanging his head high. He knows how good the year was. He was upset that they lost, rightfully so. But they had a great year, all those guys, and they're going to be a great team for years to come, Vegas. They will have an opportunity to get there again. Be very interested to see what their offseason brings. But Washington, this was the team that nobody thought would win. Washington had all these good teams for years and didn't win. You had to have that feeling when they beat Pittsburgh that this was actually the year.
It was slaying the dragon, the gorilla, and everything else on your back.
Literally, and they did. And they played with confidence and fun. Yep. And just like with Fleury this year, had a year of pure fun. I've never seen somebody have so much fun playing the game of hockey. And seeing those two teams play this year, a Cinderella story, like I said, and the legacy, and a team that hasn't won a while, it's great for the game of hockey. The team that deserved to win did. Not the better team. They're equal. I know one team doesn't have Ovechkin and one does.
Sure.
But no, they're an equal team. They both teams are evenly matched. I feel an energy, and they were very exciting to watch. Definitely a 10 out of 10 in my books for Stanley Cup Finals. Congratulations to Washington.
Yeah, and one other thing I wanted to add, Dave, is, you know, you mentioned Ovechkin and TJ Oshie, a guy that I've always liked.
Yes.
To go back to the Olympics there when he scored, 1,000 goals in that shootout against Russia. But having him and his dad, who's battling Alzheimer's, and just the emotion. And that's one of the things I want to talk about in the roundtable a little bit when we bring Katie back in is the emotion of the Stanley Cup. And, you know, other sports, yes, NBA, Major League Baseball, NFL, but the emotional attachment to the Stanley Cup and that trophy, the only thing that I can compare it to is the World Cup and we're going to talk about that during the roundtable, which is coming up this week, so you have no idea how excited I am about that, but just the emotion that the fans and everything go through. I don't think in professional sports in the United States anything comes close to the emotion and the attachment of that playoff run to earn a Stanley Cup. And a moment like that, LeBron James winning it for Cleveland, you might say that is emotional to a certain extent, but you know what? It's not the emotion, in my opinion, that it is for the Stanley Cup.
No, it's not. It's the hardest trophy to win in sports.
Right.
The longest, too, I believe.
Yeah.
It is the longest. Yes.
It's a long playoff run, a couple months.
It is grueling. It's tough. You're getting banged on the boards. You're playing every second day in an NHL-caliber setting, which is very grueling. And you know what? They earned it, the Washington Capitals. But those tears that even Oshie was shedding for his father, who has Alzheimer's.
Good.
And, you know, this was, either way, like I said, I was pulling for Colin.
Sure.
you know, that would have been great for all different reasons, as I mentioned. But, you know, to have Ovechkin win that cup and to finally prove haters wrong and to see that emotion just makes you love that game. And you know what? Ovechkin had goals in his hockey career was to win a gold medal and to win a Stanley Cup. He's won the Stanley Cup. Ironically enough, his contract expires in 2021. The next Olympics are 2022. Now, if the NHL can't get into the Olympics, I wonder if Ovechkin says sayonara to the NHL, because now he's already won the Stanley Cup. So that's something we can say for the roundtable if you want.
Sure.
But that's something we brought up on the show last night, and we even spoke of emotion on the show last night. You know, there's that emotion is just I can't speak on that emotion. The only emotion I had when I went to Tyler Kennedy's house for a Stanley Cup celebration when he had it there. The emotion I had to go up to look at and lift over my shoulder is the only emotion I had close. But I can imagine earning that trophy after a long, grueling playoff run. All the fans in front of you, you know, and celebrate it with the boys that you've done it with for 6-plus months. Ovechkin's done it with these guys for the last 10-plus years, let mind 6 months. But Backstrom, Carlson, Holtby, all these guys have been there for years, and that's why he gave the cup to Backstrom first. I thought I was going to go to Trotz first,
to
be honest.
No, that was a good call on him.
But it was a good call to give it to Backstrom. So, all in all, this Stanley Cup Finals couldn't have been any better, like I said.
And Alex Ovechkin is saying right now, you talk about the haters. You know what, Dave? The haters are going to hate.
Yeah.
The players are going to play. He's just going to shake it off.
Oh,
I figured I'd start with the song and I'd end with the song. See how I'm bridging the generational gaps there?
Seriously.
I went right from...
Eazy-E.
No, I think
Straight
it was kid Rob Bass and DJ Easy Rock.
Oh, DJ,
It Takes Two, I'm going to rock right now.
Oh, that's right.
Right to Taylor Swift.
Wow.
That's what you call being a DJ.
That is key right there. That's clutch. You know what? That's funny that you mentioned up songs, because yesterday we were talking about Sweet Emotion. We said, quoting Aerosmith.
Very good.
We said Ovechkin was partying like a summer of 69, like Brad Adams.
Canadian.
And then Brad Cochimilio said, partying like a rock star.
Nerd?
Party like a rock star. Was that nerd?
No.
Katie, I might have to go to...
Katie will look that up.
Yeah, he'll look it up. But anyways.
Dave, we're going to take a break here. Going to let you enjoy those appetizers. What did you get tonight?
These are the tater tots.
Tater tots.
A little cheese in the middle. I don't know what else. Maybe, I don't know what else Scotty put in the middle. But there's a little bit of food that's in there. And these are the best things here. Along with those spicy egg rolls.
Oh,
I was on the border, but I had to go with the tots. These are the best thing.
We're going to take a break here on the game. When we come back, we're going to invite Katie and Dave back, because we're going to have our roundtable here at the Wicked Sister, where we banter about some topics in the world of sports. That's coming up on the game here on Eagle 95.1.
The Wicked Sister, Soo, Michigan. Check TripAdvisor, ranked right towards the top. Awarded the Certificate of Excellence, as well as voted number one pub in the UP. The Wicked Sister has managed to create a casual menu that offers unique, creative, and sometimes healthy offerings that rivals menu selections of any big city. Burgers and starters, snacks and shareables, soups and salads, sandwiches and tapas. On Ashman Street, Soo, Michigan. Welcome to the Wicked Sister, where you'll be treated like family, whether you like it or not.
The Game Sports Show would like to thank a list of additional sponsors. North Shore Sports and Auto, new location located on 647 McDonald Avenue, Sault Ste. Marie. A family-owned and operated business with doing business in Sault Ste. Marie for over 10 years. Loads of products available for your enjoyment for all seasons. North Shore Sports and Auto, we understand the importance of quality service and products, and we work hard to ensure that all customers have a positive experience before and after each and every sale. North Shore Sports and Auto, meeting all of your new and pre-owned equipment needs. Special thanks to Salon. The Salon, located on 589 Second Line East, Sault Ste. Marie, Ontario, owned and operated by Mike Guglietta. Book your appointment today at 705-941-9191 or via online at https://thesalonsoo.as.me-. The Salon, making the Soo beautiful, one haircut at a time. As well as a shout out to the Soo Pee Wee Pro Shop. The Soo Pee Wee Pro Shop, located inside a Community First Credit Union Soo Pee Wee Arena, on 285 Northern Avenue East, Sault Ste. Marie, Ontario. Owned and operated by Jeremy Paquin and ran by Larry Monroe. Superior Pro Shop, for over 40 years, meet all of your skate sharpening, skate repair, and hockey needs. Also to Discover the Canvas. Discover the Canvas, located on 317 Wellington Street West, Sault Ste. Marie, Ontario. A beautiful new renovated building owned and operated by expert artist and Sault native Katrina Thibodeau. Katrina taking her talents of the ink in Sault Ste. Marie and truly creating the best and most realistic art locally. Call Katrina today at 705-450-8099 or email her at discoverthecanvas@gmail.com to book your tattoo or consultation today.
Thank you for tuning in to the game. Heard Monday nights from the Wicked Sister on Ashman Street, downtown Sault Ste. Marie, Michigan, on Eagle 95.1 and online at RadioEagleSoo.com. You can also hear the podcast of the show at thegamesportshow.com or thegamesportshow.podbean.com. I hope that you are enjoying the broadcast. If you want to hear more of the Twin Sioux's only local, regional, and national sports talk show, I encourage you to visit our website, thegamesportshow.com, and hear a pair of broadcasts from Soo Ontario. Dave, Mr. Electric Avenue McCaig, broadcasts a show on Wednesday nights from Sportscenter Bar and Grill in Soo Ontario, along with regular contributors Jamie Antonello, Justin Heichel, and Dane Hantrow. They focus on football with their very popular In the Pocket segment, talking about the National Football League, along with basketball, the NBA, and other sports, including but not limited to tennis, golf, soccer, and even the WWE. If you like hockey and baseball, Thursday nights are for you, as the Game Sports Show is at Boston Pizza in Soo, Ontario. Dave McCaig, along with regular contributors Justin Heichel and Dane Hantrow, and Brad Cochimilio from SooToday.com. This show focuses on hockey in the winter, local and national hockey, along with baseball in the summer, and includes guests and interviews with local and national figures. Once again, you can hear three versions of the game at our website, thegamesportshow.com, or at the podcast page, thegamesportshow.podbean.com. Also on the podcast page, you will find audio broadcasts of selected Soo Eagles home games, along with Brimley Bay's basketball and Soo High Blue Devil hockey. You can also find Butch Davis's show, Butch on Sports, on the podcast page, as well as my shows with Paul Van Wagner from ESPN Blacksburg on The Drive. You can also find us on YouTube. Look for the Scott Nason channel, and thank you for listening, and keep it locked here to the game for all your local, regional, and national sports talk that you just can't get enough of. Welcome back to the game on Eagle 95.1 and online at thegamesportshow.com, thegamesportshow.podbean.com, and on YouTube at the Scott Nason channel. Scott Nason here at the Wicked Sister on this Monday night for our roundtable portion of the show, joined by Katie Wollan and Dave McCaig. And the Wicked Sister has lots going on, as always. If you want to find out more about the Wicked Sister, you can go to their website, wickedsistersoo.com, or on Facebook. You can look for the Wicked Sister, and if you want them to cater an event, and I would suggest you do so, because some of my favorite lunches, sometimes I have work lunches or conferences that I have to attend. Anytime I see that the Wicked Sister is catering that event, I am all about going to that event, and they will help you out with your catering. You can call them at 259-1086. Lady and gentlemen, back here at the Wicked Sister, Katie and Dave joining us. We'll be joined by Butch Davis tomorrow night. Unfortunately, we had some technical difficulties, so we'll do a special edition of the game tomorrow night with yours truly and Butch. But this is the part of the show where we talk about the world of sports. And Katie, you're brand new to this whole experience there. I know you've listened to the show many times. I want to give you first topic as far as things you want to bring up on the show. But Dave, before we bring up that, we were talking about the last song that we referenced.
Party Like a Rockstar, Shop Boys with a Z, Katie?
With a Z.
Shop with Boys a Z. With,
we're
a Z.
Looking, with a Z.
Not to be confused with Rockstar by Nerd. That was the one I was thinking about.
No, I'm curious, because we were talking about one-hit wonders before we came back on. I would like to do a 1 hour of one-hit wonders on a live stream, something like that.
We can do it on this page.
I'd like to see that one. I want to see what the listeners think. Give us your recommendations. Shoot us your one-hit wonders. Everyone shoot them out. Scotty and I and Katie will pick them and play them.
I like it. We'll just play them.
If you come close and get the majority of the picks, maybe you'll get a T-shirt courtesy of the Game Sports
Show. Oh, fantastic. Speaking of that, Dave, that's a good segue, Katie. Just hang on one second. T-shirts. I am getting my T-shirts tonight, and I'm going to be wearing it proudly next week here at the Wicked Sister for it. Now, if anybody wants to get a T-shirt of the Game Sports Show, it's not just a T-shirt. It's not just for our show. More importantly, it goes to two great charities. Dave, tell us all about it.
It goes to Northern Critters in Need, which if you're from Sault Ste. Marie, Ontario, might know more than Sault Ste. Marie, Michigan. I'm sure it's familiar here in Sault, Michigan. I've done my research with that, but obviously more on the Canada side it's known. But since it is from my side that I kind of reach out for, Northern Critters has over 16,000 followers on Facebook that follow our show and also share our show when we upload each week, and they're obviously for animals, cats, for dogs, for any types of animals. They rescue animals. They have puppies. They try to sell them. The thing is, they want to use the portion of theirs to try to buy toys and buy items for these rescued animals. The other side is Big Brother, Big Sister. You know, Big Brother, Big Sister is an organization that already explains itself. You know, it's already well known, and that is in any Big Brother, Big Sister organization. They're going to take the money and put it towards the organization in general to help with events and try to be more active in the community. And Big Brother, Big Sister, Northern Critters in Need came on the Game Sports Show with the plan for the shirt. Now they've grown to be sponsors. They're big followers, and there are obviously a lot of people that follow them. When you buy the T-shirt, it's only $25. That's it. $25. The quality of T-shirt's amazing. I've worn it out to the bar.
Wow.
I've worn out to games, and I've gotten compliments on the shirt.
Now, is that Canadian or American? Because we need to discuss
at
this.
At par.
Oh, at par. Okay. Well.
It is at par.
We'll go to the exchange after this. That's for a good cause. I'll give you American.
It all goes 100% is towards charity. And if you do require a receipt, we can get those receipts from both Northern Critters and Big Brother, Big Sister. And you can order those shirts on thegamesportshowssm@gmail.com, or you can go to our website, www.thegamesportshow.com. You could have you just click on the merchandise tab, follow those directions. We'll deliver it to you in the United States or Canada within the Algoma region or the Upper Peninsula. Nailed it. And also, you know, if you have to pay shipping, it's only $10 for shipping anything outside of Algoma or the Upper Peninsula. So you can do that. And you also pay cash, like I said, upon pickup, or do online e-transfer online payment. So it's really convenient. We'll get the shirt same day. And if we're out of stock on your shirt, within 48 hours of it made, pressed, and brought to your door.
Wow.
So that's how quick
like
it is.
Like the UPS guy, you're just delivering.
Courtesy of Northern Signs and Sault Ste. Marie, Walker and Matt, who made it. Very good friend of mine that has done a great job with the shirt. It's got a logo on the front, two charitable logos on the back, and his business logo on the back. Very fashionable shirt. Very unisex type fit shirt as well. You definitely don't want to miss out and donate to a great cause.
Very good, Dave. Katie, this is the part of the show where we do the round table, where we banter about different topics in the world of sports. So we are going to give you honors. What would you like to bring up to tonight's round table?
I was kind of thinking about the Detroit Tigers.
Okay.
Now, we haven't talked about baseball.
We have not.
So.
Normally we do with Butch, but we couldn't have him. Okay.
So does David have some insight on the Detroit Tigers?
Well, I would say, you know, we can kind of combine this, Katie, Tigers, Blue Jays, kind of Major League Baseball in general. I'll start, Dave, before we get to you as far as, you know, you talked about the Blue Jays last night, but it would be good to kind of touch up on the Jays here. The Tigers right now, Katie, are doing okay.
Yes.
They had probably their toughest week of the season by far this past week. They had to make up a doubleheader against the New York Yankees on Monday. Then they go to Fenway Park to take on one of the best teams in baseball, Boston. Then they come back at home and take on Cleveland two or three games. Well, they didn't have a successful week, but they survived. They split the doubleheader against the Yankees. They did win one at Boston, losing two, and they did win one at home against Cleveland. So right now the Tigers, 31-36. They are still in second place in the AL Central, five games behind the Cleveland Indians. They have a day off today and will host Minnesota starting tomorrow for a three-game set before traveling to the south side of Chicago to take on the Chicago White Sox. And well, you know, going into this season, the Tigers had very, very low expectations. I don't think many people, even at this stage, had them in second place. Granted, they are five games below 500. Granted, they are in the worst division in baseball. But what I like about this team, I like their manager, Ron Gardenhire. I think he was a very good person. I think he should have been the person 4 years ago when Jim Leland retired. We can't change history, but he's a good person in charge because he's a player's coach, and we're seeing a lot of this young talent come up, guys that we haven't heard much of over the past few years that are having success. You look at a guy like Nick Catalanos that is having success. Iglesias is having a lot of success. Fulmer, not so much. Miguel Cabrera, the jury's still out. The Tigers did make a very smart pick, picking the pitcher from Auburn, first pick in the draft.
Brad said that.
So I think this is a wait and see kind of attitude. Are they gonna win the AL Central and make a run in the playoffs? Absolutely not. They're probably not gonna do it next year. But they're competitive pretty much each and every night. They're gonna have their lumps. They're gonna have games where they get blown out, but there haven't been a lot of games that they've been blown up. So, blown out rather. So, I think the Tigers are doing okay. Are they exceeding expectations? Yes. Are they going to win the playoff title in the Central and the World Series? Absolutely not. But this is a work in progress. They're pretty much at where Houston was a few years ago before they won the World Series. However, the difference is they still have a lot of these big contracts like Victor Martinez and Miguel Cabrera that they're going to have a hard time getting rid of. Dave, we'll turn it over to you. I know you're more on the Blue Jays, which you talked about last night. Any thoughts on the Tigers and the Blue Jays in Major League Baseball?
You know what? The Tigers are a team that intrigues me a lot in terms of how they're developing in the right area, in the right way, I feel, because Gardenhire, you took the words right out of my mouth. That is a very great, not good,
yeah,
not fantastic.
I wanted him 4 years ago.
Yeah, having success in Minnesota, and I really think that is where the turning point of this the Detroit Tigers is going to be, is from having a good manager at foot. So Miguel Cabrera, there's some veterans. Now, I'm poking the bear maybe a little bit here, but I think maybe they should maybe explore the option of trying to make a deal to attract some younger assets that continue to go to this organization and help grow and look at the rebuilding direction of this team for the Detroit Tigers. They're not going to make the playoffs. They have that AL is absolutely wild right now, yeah, in terms of teams winning. And the Blue Jays are not making it either. So if anyone thinks the Blue Jays are making it, unless the Blue Jays have a run like the Miracle Mets in 67,
69.
Pardon? Thank you, 69. And with the Blue Jays of 2016, with the 50-51 return, you know, coming, there's, then the Oakland Athletics having that big run with Moneyball in 2004.
Somewhere there. Billy Bean.
So there's,
with an E.
But you realize I was only able to name, what, two or three times. It's very rare that it does happen. But it does happen. Tigers can go on a 20-game winning streak. The Blue Jays can. But let's really hold our breath here. It's probably not going to happen. Both teams, I can touch on both teams in this aspect because I think they both can look towards the future. The Blue Jays don't have to look at a future that's as deep as the Tigers, I feel, because they already have Vlad Jr. as an absolute stud. Look at his numbers in the minors if you disagree.
How old is he? Like 20?
19. Ugh. 19. When he comes up next year or the year after, the guy's going to be hitting bombs like his dad used,
yeah,
to. So, Bull Bichette. You know, and Sammy Giovello, the guy who's coming up. There's a lot of young guys that are coming up the ranks of the Blue Jays that are impressive. We won't have to wait 20 more years till we're in the playoffs, I don't think. But when you have the Red Sox, the Yankees, the Angels, you have Cleveland. Cleveland's, you know, meh. But when it comes to the teams that have high budget, like L.A. and New York and Boston, like I said, hard to compete with. So you have to do it the smart way, and the Tigers are doing it that way. The Tigers' budget, I think, is a little bit higher than the Blue Jays, I feel, but the Tigers are taking it in a perspective of developing players, and that's what the Blue Jays are doing. Now, the Blue Jays, though, have one of the older teams in baseball. So people are wondering what I'm saying by that is. Pretty simple. They're going to go this year. They wanted to make the playoffs. They're supposed to be a wild card team. Based on their pitching rotation, they're one of the best rotations in baseball. Nope. I don't know what.
Not at all.
Absolutely not. So, obviously not. So, unless they smarten up, but now these are older guys. Morales, Donaldson. I'm drooling at the lips to see what they can attract for Donaldson, especially from the St. Louis Cardinals.
Yeah.
Alex Reyes, hello. There's guys that they can attract. The Tigers, Miguel Cabrera. There's guys that maybe it's a tough pill to swallow to trade your franchise guy, but it's been done. I'm a believer of that. Now, I'm not a GM of a team in the NHL, MLB, NFL, or anything like that. But if I have a team that, not for 1 year, for two or three years, much like the Tigers, are in a position where they are not making the playoffs, you're moving these veterans and bringing in young studs. That pick they did at the draft, love that pick.
Mize, I can't think. His name is Casey. But
Brad was talking about, yep, him yesterday. Brad Cochamillion from Soo Today, who's part of the show in Soo Ontario, was talking about that. And it was a great pick for them and a good step in the right direction. Now, if I'm the GM of the Blue Jays, I'm looking at them in a different perspective in terms of rebuilding quickly. Donaldson, those guys are moving out of there. Tigers are starting from the ground up. That's what they were doing, and they're on the right side. And I think they've actually expedited the process a little bit. I think they're a year ahead, not 2 years, not half a year ahead of their process, especially with Gardenhire there. Give them another year or two. These guys will be contenders in their division. The Blue Jays, touching with them, they're going to be at least 2 years away before we see another playoff game in the Rogers Center, or if it's going to remain the Rogers Center. Okay, I'm sure they'll have five more sponsors in the next couple of years because it's Toronto sports.
It used to be Exhibition Stadium when they started back
in
77.
Skydome, for,
yep,
God's sake.
Yeah.
So the names are changing all over the place. Yankee Stadium hasn't changed. Okay, so I can tell you right now, there's the Blue Jays will probably have three different names in the next 2 years. It might even be called the Game Sports Show Complex. But
wow.
If you want to go that big.
Hey,
no, but
why not?
Jokes aside, and dreams aside, it's simply put that the Blue Jays and Tigers are almost the same path.
Yeah.
Almost. The identical records, almost. I think just one game the Tigers have up.
Pretty,
on the
yeah,
Jays.
One, yeah, half
after
game
the Tigers
up.
Swept them.
Was they sweep by two or three.
Two or three in their last meeting. The Tigers and Jays are a lot evenly matched. A lot of even the Blue Jays fans don't want to hear that. A lot of veterans on that team with the Jays. The Tigers are younger, along with Seb Cabrera. These two teams can trade those older guys and make things real interesting for their organization, getting some young prospects.
Katie, your thoughts on your topic. Tigers, what are you thinking there so far this year?
Well, I definitely think, what David said was pretty accurate. But
David,
go
the full name.
But at the same time, I guess I don't know enough. But based on what I've been watching, they are rebuilding their team. And new prospects is definitely a big thing because – I don't know. David said it. I can't even.
Dave says a lot, so it's always hard to digest everything
he says.
He says
too much, so.
Oh, wow. Some might say that. I wouldn't. But
I think you would, though.
Scott might say that. He's laughing, but yeah.
You know what, though? It's interesting fact for the Tigers, right? Though, Katie, like, it's Detroit sports in general. Look at the Lions are an absolute.
Yeah.
To dare I say, crapshoot?
They're all pretty mediocre right now in Detroit
Red
sports.
Wings, yeah, it's not the best right now.
Red Wings should have filed for expansion status and be in the playoffs next year.
You know what the best direction was? Dwayne Casey going to the Pistons.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm telling you, and the Tigers, guard hire. The coaches being hired for both those teams are the step in the right direction for those sports.
Matt Patricia
Sorry,
for
Jeff
the Lions,
Washington.
I don't know about that. Boy, there's some, not some good
I'm
things
not a
being
hater
reported.
Yet. I'm not a – I know Pat DeLuca.
Making him run laps and stuff?
It's different. I think he's old school.
Yeah, he is.
A little bit old school.
Well,
but
you
I'm
know
not,
what? These guys need to kick it into gear then.
They need something called a running back, Scotty.
Well, okay. They did draft somebody.
Yeah,
they got Blunt coming from Philadelphia.
Yeah, that's a step in the right direction. Pun intended, running back.
Let's keep it going here on the game, and I am so excited because this is a week I've been looking forward to for a long, long time. Matter of fact, a little under 4 years.
I wonder.
Because you know where we're going, Dave. I am wearing my David Beckham circa 2006 World Cup in Germany uniform for England. And since the United States doesn't have a team in the World Cup, Dave, your Italy does not have a team in the World Cup. Katie, I'm not sure your nationality, but maybe you're Dutch. The Netherlands doesn't have a team in the World Cup.
Wollan, English?
German.
Well, they have a team in the World Cup.
They do.
The World Cup will be beginning on Thursday in Russia. Ironic that it's in Russia with all the news and, fake news in my opinion and some. But Russia will be hosting the World Cup starting on Thursday. Russia taking on Saudi Arabia. I know, Dave, you're going to be glued to your television for that one. But I want to know, before I give you a reason or many reasons to watch the World Cup, if you, either one of you, have any interest at all in soccer's greatest show, the biggest sporting event in the world, Super Bowl, NBA Finals, Stanley Cup, pale in comparison to the amount of people that will be watching the World Cup for about a month. It'll start on Thursday and run until mid-July. Dave, I'll start with you. World Cup, no Italy, no Canada, no U.S. What's your thoughts?
Ouch for Italy. That still stings.
That's a big one.
That is absolute disgust.
I don't think they've ever missed it, have they?
You know the enthusiasm that I use when I have my favorite sports teams or people go somewhere that shouldn't go somewhere or don't happen? Italy, that's the humiliation. That's disgusting. And I can tell you, my uncle, family that live in Italy, oh my. A lot of people there's not one person happy. Rightfully, there shouldn't be anybody happy. So that makes you question the program, and they better be altering that program quick because that is the pastime, as they would say, in Italy. So they have to smarten the heck up because I'm having Italy in there. Almost, it's losing a lot of interest here, especially in Soo Ontario, being a little Italy itself.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's teams in the World Cup in general. I have my eye, of course, on Argentina. That's where my eyes are right now. Me being a Messi fan, you know, that's – people are going to wonder if I'm bandwagon jumping. Absolutely. How I started watching soccer was Buffon with Italy winning in 2006.
Yep.
You know, that's where I started
over
watching.
France.
Yep. And then when I think Messi went to Barcelona in 2010.
Correct.
Around that area. So that's Messi. I actually thought he was Italian at first. If you want to know
the story. Kids look Italian,
does,
yeah.
But I found out he was Argentinian, but it didn't change anything. So I started liking Barcelona. Then they got stacked. So then I just ironically liked them at the right time. And so I look like a bandwagon jumper, which you can call me, sure. But not having Italy in the World Cup is something that's going to be strange to watch because they were a team that's always favored to go on and could be favored. Look at Spain. Look at Argentina. Yeah. Germany are a team that shouldn't be taken lightly as well.
There's not a lot of countries England. That have won World Cups.
No, there hasn't been. And I really think that Argentina is the team to watch. And I think that's the team that is going to win it this year. I have a feeling for Argentina.
Katie, any thoughts on the World Cup? She's saying, no, I don't watch soccer. You're among many. Well, I'm going to give you all a reason to watch the World Cup. It's one of my favorite sporting events. I'm a big soccer guy. I put it on par as far as the Stanley Cup and any other, the Super Bowl. It's just something that I follow on a regular basis, both domestically in the Premier League and, you know, some of the other divisions in the world, but I really love the World Cup. My introduction to the World Cup, Dave, was back in 1994 when the U.S. hosted the World Cup. This was before the MLS. Soccer was pretty much non-existent in this country, and I remember a friend of mine that was Italian descent invited me over to the Marconi Club over in Soo Ontario for the 94 final between Italy and Brazil. Was won by Brazil in penalty kicks, and I have never seen a group of people more upset in my life. I don't know what the heck they were saying, but I know they weren't saying things very nice.
No.
And so that really got me interested in soccer, and it's really grown over the years, having been in the United States Navy and living over in England, being ingratiated into the soccer culture for 3 years. I lived over there for 3 years. That's where I really became a soccer fan. And just watching the passion and how so many people just live and die by not just their clubs from their towns, but also their country. Because, you know, people in the United States and Canada, we have so many things. We have so many sports. We have, especially here in the United States, Major League Baseball teams. We have NFL teams. We have NHL teams. We have MLS. We have so many different teams. College sports. Over in England, they have soccer. And that's pretty much it. They have cricket teams. They have rugby teams. But the soccer is such a big thing. It's part of life. And when your country plays in the World Cup in countries like Brazil and countries like Italy, Netherlands, the list goes on and on. It's so just emotional. We talked about that with the Stanley Cup. There's so much emotion in sports. And there's so much pressure on so many of these athletes. You look at Brazil. 4 years ago, hosting the World Cup, everybody thought that they were going to run away at the World Cup. They got beat 7-1 by Germany in Brazil. And those players have not heard the end of that for 4 years. Now they're finally, many of them that are still on the team have a chance to redeem themselves. And the emotion and just the beautiful game, as I call it. And, you know, some people will say soccer is a boring game to watch. I equivocate it to a chess match. It's a lot of strategy. And anybody can beat anybody on a given day. You look at a country like Iceland, and y'all, people in the United States are looking for a team to root for, maybe even in Canada, Dave, for you and your Italian friends. Root for a country like Iceland. They only have 400,000 people in their whole country, and they're in the World Cup. They qualify, the United States doesn't. How about a team like England that I'm wearing right now? They haven't won a World Cup since 1966. They're due. They are very due. So there's lots of great stories to write. It's going to be some great football, or soccer, if you will. And so I encourage anyone, you know, it's a good time because between mid-July and mid-June, there's not a lot of sports going on, really. You know, you have everybody else done, Major League Baseball, not quite into the pennant races, so there's not a lot of other competition. So I encourage everybody out there, watch some of the matches. Don't watch all the matches. Don't watch maybe, you know, Saudi Arabia, Russia. Okay, that's the first match. Watch on Friday, Spain, Portugal, two of the best teams in Europe that will be playing on that day. Watch on Saturday, Iceland taking on Argentina, a team that I think has a lot to prove, and Messi, this might be maybe his last chance to get a World Cup. Watch on Sunday, Germany and Mexico. Watch this German machine, and they are a machine. They are tactically sound, and Mexico maybe the closest thing we have to a local team, if you will. There's lots of great stories. Looking at teams I think that will win it, the odds say that Germany and Brazil are the two best teams. They can't meet in the finals due to the way the groups were set. They could meet, I believe, in the semifinals, But a South American team has only won once when the World Cup has been held in Europe. That was in 1958 by Brazil, I might add. So I don't know. If I had to pick a team that I think will win, it's Germany, but the World Cup has not had a repeat winner since 1962 with Brazil. A team that I'm watching, Argentina, you said it, Dave, and I'm watching England. I think maybe, just maybe, this is England's time. They would have to play Germany either in the round of 16 or the quarterfinals. I'm all about the World Cup. Every game will be on Fox Sports, probably, I believe, TSN over in Canada.
Will be.
You can also find it on ESPN Desportes. So if you get a chance to watch the World Cup, we'll definitely be talking about it here on this show. Can you tell I'm excited about this, guys?
You're very excited. I've never seen him this excited.
This is my, David. Because he knows no one will talk about it. Exactly.
I don't even think he took a breath when he was talking.
Yeah, I did. Yeah. I think I took one. Dave, we just got time for one more topic on the game. Katie, I'll give you first shot if you so choose. What would you like to bring up on tonight's roundtable, Mr. Electric Avenue?
Oh, wow. That's an old nickname. I love it, though.
Old?
He's not old. I'm not old.
No.
We're all young.
We're all young here. Oh, yeah. Beat me to the punch on that, Katie. But Alex Ovechkin, I'm going to that route. I want to go to the state of the NHL going to the Olympics in 2022, and if Alex Ovechkin jumps ship to the KHL, if they don't go there because of his legacy. Now that he's already won how many Maurice Richards, he's won a Conn Smythe, he's won trophies, he's won that Stanley Cup he's been waiting for. If the NHL doesn't go to the Olympics, does he leave? And also, does the NHL come to the agreement with the Olympics? Katie, I know that's a topic of math for you. I apologize to throw you under the bus, but let me give you a quick little Kohl's Notes point of this.
Kohl's Notes?
Kohl's Notes. You know what that is?
The department store?
No, yeah. You have that?
Oh, C-O-L-E-S. I'm thinking K-O-H-L-S.
Oh, yeah.
Our Kohl's is like merchandise, like clothing. Your Kohl's is the bookstore.
Bookstore,
at the Station Mall. I've been in there several times.
Alex Ovechkin's a Russian hockey player, obviously, as you know. He wanted to go to the Olympics. He wasn't allowed to this year. He was going to quit the NHL to go there. He didn't. He won the Stanley Cup this year. Now, he said that if they don't go by 2022, he will leave the NHL to go there.
Okay.
His contract ends in 2021, the year before the Olympics.
Which he'll be, about 38 years old at that point?
37.
Yeah.
37 years old.
That include me? Clerk's reference.
Never mind. Okay, then my bad.
Yeah.
Sorry, Scott.
Someone will get that back
so
in the crowd.
Now somebody who has won the cup now, he's won awards, he's already scored a bunch of goals in the National Hockey League, has records. The only thing he wants now is a gold medal, thing he's never won. He has a chance to go there after his contract expires if the NHL does not come to an agreement.
And that's on his bucket list. He wants to.
I think so. What do you think, Katie? What should he do?
Well, he pretty much put the words in all our mouths.
Almost. I'll answer mine after.
I mean, he's asking a question, but he's pretty much saying that he thinks and everyone should think, and he thinks that he's going to go to the Olympics.
What do you think? Not what Dave thinks. It's what Katie thinks right now.
But, you can't put that on me.
I'm putting all the pressure in the world on you right now.
What would you do?
What would you do?
Well,
you want a Stanley
Cup?
If
I'm in his shoes, mm-hmm. I would.
Or skates.
Yep, there you go. That's a good one. I guess I would, go to the Olympics then.
So you quit the NHL, give
might
up your contract.
Might as well, if you've already gotten the Stanley Cup, you might as well.
What I think, David, I think the NHL will have Olympians in the NHL or in the Olympics, or the NHL players in the Olympics in 2022. I mean, it makes sense. I thought maybe that the Olympics might be a little more interesting without NHL players in it. It wasn't. It sucked. I agree. It was 100% it sucked. And I think if Ovechkin, given the option, which you stated, I think he would jump ship. And he should jump ship. He's won a Stanley Cup. He's going to be at the end of his contract. He wants to win for his country, as a lot of players do. And so I think he goes. What do you say?
Honestly, like Katie said, it put in a lot of different perspective. But I honestly feel that Ovechkin loves the city of Washington. I know he wants to win a gold medal. I said it on the show last night that I said that he would go overseas. So I can't change that answer because I have to stick to exactly what I said. And after you think about it, though, makes you wonder, he wants to win a gold medal in the Olympics. If he goes to the KHL, he'll score 80 goals there. He'll be the most purified goal scorer to ever play in the KHL, better than Kovalchuk. He'll be better than Datsyuk, but Datsyuk and Ovechkin are two different players. So I think Ovechkin's going to be on the level of, yes, I will go to the Olympics. And I think, though, to the other side of my question, the NHL is going to come to an agreement by then, though. And that's my point to the question.
I think they have to.
Because they're going to look at it and be like, okay, Ovechkin will leave. Will Crosby?
Yeah.
Will guys literally consider playing the KHL just to have a taste of the Olympics? People want to play for their country. People want to represent their country. People want to win that gold medal. And let me tell you, if Canada, I'm sorry, United States and Russian fans, if Canada was able to ice the team that they were supposed to ice this year, there'd be no team able to match that team.
100%.
McDavid, Crosby, yeah. That's enough said right there. So I think U.S. have a very strong team with Matthews. So at the end of the day, yeah, it's very great to represent your country. And yes, I think Ovechkin will jump ship. But by then, the NHL has to come to an agreement. They have to. It gives them money. Believe it or not, the NHL is a business, believe it or not. Bettman has been the commissioner for well over 20
long
years.
Time.
A long time. Well over 20 years. It's been 25 years since he's been able to give a Canadian team a Stanley Cup. Okay, so
93.
Yep, the Montreal Canadiens, boo. But Gary Bettman has to come to a point and talk to the NHLPA. They have to come to an agreement with this because it's going to make the NHL more money. They have expansion teams coming by then. Seattle. What if they go to Quebec again?
There's
two more teams. So, you know, they have teams that need the NHL needs the business. They'll make the money. If they're not there, though, Ovechkin's gone.
Let's get to our thumbs up and thumbs down for the week. Katie, first of all, great job. Our first time on the show. I know a little nerves, but you did great. Do you have any thumbs up or thumbs down for the week? I forgot to mention that we do this on the show.
Well, thumbs up for the Pistons, of course.
There you
that's
go.
That's my favorite
there
team.
There you go.
Got to be loyal to your Detroit Pistons.
Yes,
if
you
you're
do.
From Michigan. So yep. I hope it all works out. And, you know, hopefully, I mean, just like you said, there's not much salary cap left. So something's got to give right now. There's got to be hope.
Any thumbs down?
Thumbs down.
Be honest.
Thumbs down.
You have every right to critique.
Oh, how about we turn this one to David and I'll get back to you.
Okay. Dave McCaig, your thumbs up and thumbs down for the week, sir.
That's cool.
Tough questions tonight.
Very tough. Thumbs up to two teams called the Las Vegas Golden Knights and the Washington Capitals. Tremendous Stanley Cup final. In particular, my boy Colin Miller. Fantastic year, my friend. You lit it up. And Alex Ovechkin finally getting what you deserve. And the partying you're doing matches times five what I did at my bachelor party.
And why not?
Sorry, not my bachelor party week of my friend.
You getting married?
Yikes, no. Yikes, no. But yeah, I got to give the thumbs up to that. It's absolutely amazing and great to see. Thumbs down. I'm going to go to LeBron James. Oh, I love
it. Wow, critiquing. I was just thinking that. It's like he took it from me.
That's all right. You can have
again.
A co-thumbs down.
You can have, but my LeBron James is the way he answers questions to the media. I understand.
Excuses.
I understand the annoyance with questions with media. I get they ask repeated questions. Sit there and answer the questions like a professional. Don't walk out and have excuses. It wasn't. You were a big part, if not the only part of the reason making it there. Trust me, true sports experts know that already. Now, don't be negative. That already tarnishes your legacy. And like, there never was one when it came to comparing you to Michael Jordan anyways. Because the day you win a Defensive Player of the Year is the day that I'll give you credit on the show for actually being close to Michael Jordan. And I don't think MJ lost in the finals, did he?
No, 6-0.
Yeah, so you're not MJ. Yeah, you're the best player in the NBA.
LeBron,
right?
Actually, 3-6?
You know yeah, 3-6. Yeah. I think you're still the best NBA player in the NBA right now, but LeBron's attitude is an absolute joke, and he's supposed to be a role model for players. He is a role model for players on the court, but off the court he is absolutely not professional, not a leader that I'd like to be a part of.
Katie, anything you want to add? I think Dave said it all.
No, you got more points, Katie.
Come on,
you know,
give LeBron the business.
In my soul.
No, you can't do that on this show.
Yeah, you
I mean, I'm not really a huge LeBron James fan, but.
Nor am I a Kevin Durant fan.
I know, he did tell me that earlier, that you're not a KD fan.
No, call him a coward a couple years ago. Coward.
But his MVP speech, though.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You're the real MVP speech is what won my heart with KD, so you need
there
to kind of maybe look at that again.
He got paid to say that.
We'll get to my thumbs up and thumbs down. Thumbs up, I got a bunch of them. A thumbs up to the Rudyard Bulldogs softball team, their first ever regional final victory. They'll advance to the quarterfinal and take on Roger City on Tuesday. We'll have their head coach, hopefully next week, Kurt Kukoski. Been watching that group for a few years, umpiring, and they have built a solid program. Was nice to see. They have great coaches and great players down there, so congratulations to Rudyard and good luck to them this week. Thumbs up to Rafa Nadal, his 11th French Open title, 11. Can you believe that? 11 major championships. The lefty defeated Dominic Thiem in straight sets, winning his 17th Grand Slam through a drift of my boy, Roger Federer, for the all-time record at 20. So great job, Rafa. And congratulations and thumbs up to Justify.
Justify.
The horse. Triple crown, baby. Won a triple crown there at the Belmont Stakes this weekend, joining American Pharoah as the last triple crown winner in 2015. And thumbs down just to the NBA Finals.
Oh, God.
It was boring. It was predictable. And it was everything that the Stanley Cup Finals was not. And I like the NBA. Don't get me wrong. I'm not an NBA hater. But they had a good conference finals round with Cleveland and Boston.
Yes.
Also Houston and Golden State. But, boy, the finals was a dud.
Lucky
I think
Kyrie.
The radios, yeah, and the ratings proved it as much. Well, Dave and Katie, want to thank you both for joining us at the Wicked Sister. Katie, we're going to get you on Mondays here from time to time during the summer. We appreciate you coming on. How do you feel about the final show, about this show, I should say?
Well, I have the best two people in the biz when it comes to sports, so I couldn't have asked for anything better.
What? Okay, I don't know who you're trying to fly.
That's all right.
Where right now?
Like President Trump when it comes to flattery.
Where's Tim and Sid? Just keep
bringing it.
Where's Tim and Sid right now? Like I don't know. You're talking with the two best sport. No, but I appreciate that.
Katie, great job, and we'll hopefully talk to you next week, if not in the future here on the game.
Of course. Thanks for having me, Scott, and Dave, I guess, as well.
And Dave McCaig, host of the Game Sports Show from Soo Ontario, Boston Pizza, and the Sportscenter Bar and Grill. What is on tap for you this week, sir, as far as shows?
You know, before I say that, Katie, thumbs up to you, too. I should give a notable thumbs up to you. You know what? You deserve it. You did awesome. Well, here. You know, you did fantastic. But no,
I sense the sarcasm.
No, I'm totally kidding.
That was not sarcasm.
No, that was good.
I know his sarcasm. Fantastic. That wasn't
actually,
it.
I have no voice. That's
yeah, you're
strong.
What's going on
yeah,
there? Too much of the weekend?
Oh, not the band. I was screaming at the bar this weekend, singing songs. Oh, my God.
That's your band, the weekend.
He's good. All right,
wait,
he's
it's
good.
One guy. Never mind.
He's fantastic. I feel
yeah,
it coming.
I went to his concert last year. Why didn't you go with me?
Well, you didn't invite me.
I'm sorry.
Ouch. Anyways, invite must have got lost in mail. Anyways, for the show this week, we're going to have our show this week at Sportscenter Bar and Grill. Myself, Jamie Antonello, and newcomer for the summer show, Matt Primo, the head coach of the Sabercats.
That's right. We talked about them earlier. The varsity or JV? The,
varsity. JV.
The JV. They won this weekend.
Yeah, they
did.
They went. So, wow. Sorry, Matt. Going to get my I's dotted and T's crossed over here before I talk sometimes. But, you know, with having them on the show, they shared us on their Instagram page. It's great to announce that partnership on Wednesdays. We'll have players, we'll have executives and coaches on the show weekly with Sabercats and local football. Great to touch the local aspect. And also we're going to be involved in Soo Minor Baseball.
Very good.
That'll be announced on Wednesday with terms of whom we're partnering up with that and get some interviews with them for Wednesday's show to spice up that Wednesday show that's already really spicy.
It is very spicy.
But it's every second Wednesday in the summer months. The summer months for us go June till August 31st. When it goes back in September after Labor Day weekend, we'll be back to once a week at Sportscenter Bar and Grill. Myself, Jamie, Justin will be there, and Matt Primo this Wednesday, and also hoping Dustin Grandin shows up too. So we have a big panel on Wednesday, and then Thursday we'll be at Boston Pizza. Be myself, Brad Cochimilio, and Justin Heichel, along with Lane Burton. We're hoping to come by, another who's been on the show before. He's one of the associate coaches with the Soo Thunderbirds minor hockey team, and also he's the guy that predicted the Stanley Cup Finals and the Stanley Cup winner back February 8th.
Oh, February 8th.
So February 8th on the show on the game. You can listen to that show on the Podbean page. I promised him that I would get him on the show right away after and give him credit and call him the man on live air and say I was wrong. So he's going to be on air. We're going to say that. And we're hoping that we're going to have Brian Rust on this week. We're in talks trying to get Brian Rust on from the Pittsburgh Penguins.
Very good.
Friends with his fiance, trying to get stuff arranged there this week. Also, Brett Finley. We're a lot of things going on this week for the Game Sports Show on Wednesdays, Thursday from Boston Pizza. So make sure you come on by. Both shows were there after 9 p.m. on both Wednesday and Thursday.
And again, you can find those shows at two places, thegamesportshow.com or the podcast page, thegamesportshow.podbean.com. Once again, Dave, Katie, thanks for joining us. We'll talk to you hopefully next week here at the Wicked Sister for another edition of the game.
Booyah.
That's going to do it here from the Wicked Sister on this Monday night. Don't forget, we'll have a special edition of the game with Butch Davis tomorrow night. We'll put that online as well as we had some technical issues. We'll get those sorted out for next week. We'll talk to you next Monday night right here at the Wicked Sister on Eagle 95.1.
Thanks for tuning into the game on Eagle 95.1. Tune in every Monday night at 6 for local sports talk on The Game from the Wicked Sister on Ashman in downtown Sault Ste. Marie. You can hear the full two-hour broadcast of The Game, including regional and national sports talk and guests, on the podcast page, snason.podomatic.com.
Or you can find the link on our Eagle 95.1 Facebook page.
We now return you to your regularly scheduled program.
Eagle 95.1, WUPN, Paradise, Sault Ste. Marie.